Dedication by Father Edson Wood, Chaplain, United States Military Academy.
Let us pray. Eternal God, source of life, as our nation struggles near and far to defeat those who would destroy our way of life, Army and Navy meet once again on a field of friendly strife. Bless the cadets and the midshipmen of the academies. Give them a deep commitment to service and dedication. May our academies always and forever make this nation proud. Sustain all the members of our armed forces and their families throughout the world, especially those in areas of tremendous risk. Be merciful to those who have given their lives to keep the nation free. Fill each heart in this stadium today with the conviction that what we do here shows the world the deep beauty of a free and proud people. And finally, Heavenly Father, hear once more the constant prayer of our hearts. May you bless the United States of America and all those who live and die to make it for all time the land of the free and the home of the brave. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing for the singing of the national anthem by Cadet Andrew Betson, class of 2004, Company B2, and accompanied by the United States Military Academy Band.
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
When we come back, Ion Eagle and Boomer Esiason with the 104th Army-Navy game after this message and a word from your local station.
The Home Depot College Football on CBS is sponsored by the Home Depot, the United States Army, Jeep, and by Miller.
United States. The history of our nation has been written here.
The United States Naval Academy in Annapolis, the sailing capital of the Americas, the training ground for careers at sea.
Civil War generals Grant, Sherman, Lee, and Jackson. Generals Pershing, MacArthur, Eisenhower, and Patton. They all walked the halls at West Point.
George Dewey, Bull Halsey, Alan Shepard, the first American in space, all got their sea legs in Annapolis.
More than a century ago, visitors from the Naval Academy were looking for a fight on the football field.
Navy won that first game 24-0. The Army-Navy rivalry was born.
Army football rose to legendary heights. Three consecutive national titles in the 40s. Heisman trophies for Mr. Inside, Doc Blanchard, and Mr. Outside, Glenn Davis. And one a decade later for a cadet named Dawkins.
The Naval Academy was undefeated in 1926. Heisman trophies came in the 60s. First, it was the Winchester rifle, Joe Bellino, who ran away from the field. And 3 years later, a quarterback named Staubach scrambled his way to the award.
We sing On Brave Old Army Team, and we shout, Go Army, beat Navy.
For us, it's anchors away, and go Navy, beat Army.
But when our nation is threatened, these gridiron rivalries dissolve, and Army and Navy stand shoulder to shoulder.
Our duty is clear. We are honor bound to protect and serve.
And to band together to the end as brothers.
Service academies, one flag. It is still the purest rivalry in all of sports, one that's built on emotion, pride, and tradition. Today, another chapter will be written in this historic series at a brand new venue here in Philadelphia. It is America's Classic. And for the eighth consecutive year, CBS Sports is proud to present Army-Navy for the first time inside Lincoln Financial Field. Navy at 7-4, Army 0-12, and the Black Knights make their way onto the field. Disappointment this season for the Black Knights. Todd Berry, their head coach, let go after an 0-6 start and still looking for their first win as they try to salvage their season in their biggest game of the season against Navy. John Mumford, the interim head coach, taking over under tough conditions. But Army can negate a great deal of the heartache this year with a W here this afternoon in Philadelphia. Johnson in his second year at the helm, and he's got the midshipmen off to a bowl game, the Houston Bowl. Hi everybody and welcome. Ian Eagle along with Boomer Esiason, honored to be a part of this Army-Navy Classic, and the buildup on the two campuses at West Point and Annapolis, it's so big. Every year you and I have had the good fortune of getting around and participating this week.
Ian, it's been great. Emotion is definitely the word of the week. Patriotism and pride, just as some of the emotions that I felt. And to be here in Philadelphia, to see the Brigade of Midshipmen, the Corps of Cadets, it is absolutely a spectacular sight. And you quickly realize it's the best of what America has to offer. And on a side note, little 7-year-old Griffin Colton came up to me today before the game to say hi. And I said, who are you rooting for, Army or Navy? And he said, Uncle Boomer, I'm rooting for them both. And I said, both? How could you root for both of them? He said, you know what? They both protect the USA. And I think that kind of sums up the emotions here in the stadium today.
I like the Uncle Boomer part. Yes. I thought that was special. Time for the coin toss in a game that has so much meaning around the world. Let's go down onto the field.
The Honorable Anthony J. Principe, Secretary of Veterans Affairs. The Army Captains, number 4, Ryan Kent. Number 81, Clint Woody. Number 40, Brian Hill. Number 19, Aaron Alexander. Number 16, Greg Washington. And for Navy, the captains are number 11, Craig Cantito, and number 56, Eddie Carthen.
Navy, you're the visiting team. That is a head. That is a. What is your call?
Heads.
You called heads.
Mr. Secretary, do the honor, please.
It is a head. Navy has won the toss. You want to defer. Navy won the toss, has deferred.
Army, you want the football.
Which one would you like to hit? Turn around, please. Army will receive. Gentlemen, have a great football game.
We are moments away from the opening kick. Time right now to welcome in the two other members of our broadcast team here today, Tracy Wolfson and Dwayne Ballen. First, downstairs to Tracy.
Thanks, Zion. I'm here with Navy head coach Paul Johnson. And coach, you're guaranteed a winning season. You're going to a bowl game for the first time since 1996, but your season isn't complete yet, is it?
No, not by a long shot. This is the biggest game of the year, and hopefully we're ready. I know it's gonna take a great effort by our guys, because I know Army's gonna play hard.
Well, good luck today, coach.
Right.
Now let's go over to the Army sideline and Dwayne Ballen.
Thank you, Tracy. For the past 2 weeks, West Point has been deluged with emails, phone calls, and letters of support from soldiers around the world and from distinguished alumni such as Heisman Trophy legend Glenn Davis. But they've also had a reminder at West Point for the last 365 days that they're on. Each day that the cadets sat down to mess, they were greeted with these cartons emblazoned across the front: Go Army, beat Navy. Ian and Boomer, as you said earlier, this is the game at West Point.
All right, Dwayne, thank you very much. Tracy as well. The weather conditions, and what a change we have had here in Philadelphia. It was snowing on and off for the last day and a half. Huge flakes here in the city of brotherly love, but the snow has stopped. Temperature has steadied at 28 degrees. Just a couple minutes ago, the skies actually opened up and we saw some sun. As we take a look at the series, no, Army leads the all-time series with a mark of 49-47-7. First meeting, have to go back to 1890. Navy, a 24-0 winner. Last year, lopsided. Craig Candido, 6 touchdowns, a 58-12 win for the midshipmen. This is the 15th different venue to host this classic game. Navy won the toss, but they have deferred. So Navy will kick it off to William White, very dangerous return man, third team Conference USA. Jeff Blumenfeld on the kick, and we are underway. The nation's rivalry. Part of the 15-yard line. Chuck Wilkie up the middle and across the 40. Good field position for Army to open up with a 26-yard return, as Blumenfeld, the kickoff man, had to make the stop on special teams. For Army, the starting quarterback, Zach Domin, a record-breaking year this season. He is only a sophomore out of Fort Worth, Texas. Over 2,100 yards passing, 11 touchdowns, 17 interceptions. He looks young, he is young, but he's a tough competitor. and will throw on first down, airs it out. Upfield and nobody home, looking for Aaron Alexander. It's incomplete with Shalamar Brazier in on coverage. Let's take a look at our Earthlink starting lineups here this afternoon in Philadelphia. And for the Black Knights of Army, across that offensive line, Glover, Wojcik, Troy, Beer, and Neiman. Backs and receivers for Army, Carlton Jones, the sophomore, Alexander, Woody, White, the wideouts, and Doug O'Ray, the junior tight end. Tyler Robinson has checked in the backfield. He is a freshman from Greenwich, Connecticut. On the move, cutting it upfield. And forced back, William White, unable to get to the perimeter. But he gains 4 yards. Ralph Henry on the stop along the sideline. Defensively for Navy, this is a much improved unit from 1 year ago when they won just 2 games. Defensive line, Chase Akinbemi and Jeff Vanek. Linebackers, the bread and butter of this group, playmakers like Jackson McLaren and the senior co-captain Eddie Carthen. And in the secondary, Little, Brazier, Price, Sanders, and Vaughn Kelly. Josh Smith, one of the leading tacklers on this team, had his appendix taken out earlier this week. He has been released from the hospital, but not in attendance. Domin throwing on third down, and nowhere to go as White hauls it in. A loss of 3 as Brazier makes a quick tackle on the play, and Army is forced to punt.
That was a nice play by Brazier that time, Ian. He read the wide receiver screen, came down and made the tackle, and John Brown, the offensive coordinator of Army, said he was going to go up early and often the first play of the game. He took that shot, but he's got to calm his quarterback down a little bit. I'm sure his emotions are running a little bit high today.
Alex Bradford will punt it for the Black Knights. Jason Tomlinson is standing at his own 22 for Navy. Bradford just under 39 yards per punt. High kick, and Tomlinson, the fair catch, just outside the 25-yard line. Craig Candido, co-captain, the leader of this Navy offense.
Poster boy.
He is. Blonde, blue-eyed, the quarterback. Can you relate it all, Boomer?
A little bit, but you know, I'll tell you what, he's got all the intangibles that you want, and what a terrific game he had last year against Army. 6 touchdowns in a record-setting performance.
He told us that he watched the tape over Christmas break from last year's game. A couple of his friends taped it for him. He couldn't believe that was him. It still felt like a dream. On the handoff to big Kyle Echo through the middle. Over 1,000 yards rushing this season out of South Philadelphia, and he gained 7. On first down across that line for the Naval Academy here this afternoon. Wilson, Phillips, Green, Gooden, and Hughes. Only one senior, so a lot of returning starters next year. Backs and receivers, big numbers. Tony Lane, Kyle Echol, Amir Jenkins, Lionel Wesley, and the junior Eric Roberts. Double threat Roberts, rushing and catching the football. They'll try Echol once again. 3-yard gain for Echol. As we take a look at the defensive unit for Army. Up front for the Black Knights, Mike Clark, Sullivan, Landry, and Odine Brathwaite, all juniors. Linebackers Kent, Hill, Washington, and Daniels, two seniors in the group. Kent and Hill, great careers at West Point. Delente Brewer, Deion Tarver, and Ray Stiff, part of the Black Knight secondary.
You know, when you watch this Navy offense, it's described to you as a spread offense. It's really a triple option offense with no tight ends. It's a first down for Navy, and it all starts and ends with the fullback, and the quarterback is reading the defensive ends as he makes his decision whether or not to keep it or pitch it.
And the pitch. Roberts cutting to the outside, the elusive running ability as he gains 7. And that is the huge difference going against this triple option, where you just don't know who's going to carry the football and when. They come at you from so many different angles.
Averaging 323 yards a game, number one in the nation. And I was talking to Paul Johnson, the head coach, before the game, and he was telling me that, you know what, it's all about the quarterback, his decision making, and we don't even block the defensive ends.
John,
so I don't like the sound of that.
John Mumford, interim head man. Back on October the 13th, he was named to the position as Sullivan makes the stop on Kyle Echol. So they come up a little bit short. It's been mostly Echol so far for the Naval Academy. Mumford, fourth year at West Point, and Paul Johnson, second year as the head coach at Navy, took over a program that had gone 1-20 the previous 2 years. He has changed the culture in Annapolis.
He really has, and Navy is going to the Houston Bowl, so a great job by the head coach, Paul Johnson.
On 3rd-and-1, Echols got it, and a little bit more. You know the fullback's going to carry it, and there's still nothing you can do about it defensively as he picks up 5 through the gut.
You know, and I was talking to Paul Johnson, and he was telling me, listen, this is the deal. We don't really block the defensive linemen. Our offensive linemen try to get up on the linebackers. And, you know, as a former quarterback, I said, what do you mean you don't block the defensive linemen?
You were offended.
I kind of was offended. I said, that's not kind of the offense I want to play in. But really what it comes down to is that these defensive players for Army can't overcommit at the line of scrimmage. They have to be disciplined. They have to tackle who they're supposed to, the fullback first, the quarterback second, and then somebody out of the secondary has got to come and make a play on the pinch man.
And they're moving the football from midfield. Candido wants to throw. Candido, pump fake, has that running ability and scoots out of bounds after a gain of 10. Chasing him down, the inside linebacker, Greg Washington. And another first down for the midshipman.
Well, these are one of the things that you don't really worry about when you're playing and you're game planning, because these are the things that just happen spontaneously, and this is what a running and elusive quarterback can do for you. And I'll tell you what, he has just absolutely been fantastic in this offense all year long, and it's really probably, as any coach would tell you, the heart and soul of this football team.
Well, Paul Johnson told us Candido looks like a choir boy, looks like the boy next door, but he's as tough as nails, and he's proven it over the last 2 seasons. Bouncing to the outside, it's Candido, and a gain of 5.
I'm asking Paul Johnson as well about just the way that you want your quarterback to be, and whether or not he has, you know, the instincts of making these types of plays. And you could see right there in the play previous that he has all the feel, the pocket presence, the understanding of where he can find a hole and make some yardage. And, you know, I'll tell you what, he has had an absolutely spectacular season.
7 plays so far on this drive for Paul Johnson's offense, all of them running plays. Tony Lane in motion. And the inside handoff goes to Echol. Army was prepared for it. Just about everybody on that Black Knights defense limits him to a gain of 1. Mike Clark leading the charge.
Remember, we were talking to Brian Hill before the game, a linebacker from Army, and he was telling us, well, this kid Candido is really a difference maker, and we have to be so aware of not only him, but really the fullback. We have to pile on the fullback, and that's where it all starts for them.
Hill told us he played with Candido down in Florida in a high school all-star game.
He remembered him, but Candido didn't remember Hill.
That's the quarterback. The quarterback doesn't remember anybody. The linebackers, they seem to have good, strong memories. Once again, the inside handoff, and Echol is stood up at the line of scrimmage. On 3rd down, Michael Resnick, a linebacker, shifts over to make the play. Delente Brewer helping to finish him off.
You know, the one thing that you do know is Navy's going to go for it. They go for it quite a bit, 4th and short. They are so confident that they can gain a yard with this offense. And this is, you know, these are the plays that you have to make if you're Army. And you're the underdog, and you have an opportunity to stop a team. Right now is the place you have to do it.
On a 4th and 1, such confidence in their ground game for Navy. Candido, a long count. And he'll take a timeout. Army did not budge along that line of scrimmage. And the clock stops with 9:05 to play in the first. Navy driving on Army in Philly.
This week by visiting. You know, this has huge ramifications all over the globe for the United States military. No question, it was powerful. Just listening to these players talk about how important this game is.
See what Navy has done on 4th down this season. 4th and 1. The pitch goes outside. Tony Lane's got the 1st down inside the 20-yard line. They needed 1. They pick up 13. Ray Stiff, the corner, makes the stop.
And you know, you talk about getting a yard, and you would think that a quarterback might try to force the issue here. Just make the 1st down, but Candido doesn't do that. He reads it perfectly. In comes the end. The safety down deep comes inside, does not go outside, and Candido just with great poise and just flips it out there, and an easy play first down for Navy.
The 11th play of the drive, all of them on the ground. Inside the 20, they hand it off. Kyle Echol banging through to the 5-yard line. Dennis Ray Phillips, the junior left guard, with a key block from Katy, Texas, to help spring Echol.
Well, if anybody looks like a fullback, it's Kyle Echol. Not much of a neck, and I got to tell you something. He just piles through the line like this. Take a look at this. He runs over guys, breaks tackles. And when you talk to him, he's just got so much spirit. And look at that hole in the middle of that defensive line.
He patterns his running style after John Riggins, a big guy that will plow you over. Echol again. Through the hole. Is he in? Navy feels as if they've got the score.
You know, right now, Army's defense obviously, you know, overwhelmed by this Navy spread offense, this triple option offense that they're throwing at them. And right, if you're the Army defense, you have to create a turnover. You have to get some momentum, because right now Navy is completely in control of this football game from an offensive standpoint.
Echol had 167 yards rushing, 2 touchdowns in a 63-34 win over Central Michigan. Navy's last game. They've been very successful in the red zone. Candido, quarterback keeper, second effort, and he doesn't get there. The Black Knights stand up, the Navy quarterback, right at the goal line.
Tremendous surge by the defensive line of Army this time, displacing the line of scrimmage, and look at that. Candido struggling, trying to get around the corner. I would have went down probably about 3 seconds prior to that, but you know, this kid has got some heart. He never stops. Nice play by the defensive line and linebackers of Army.
Mike Clark, Delente Brewer in on that tackle. Now a 3rd and goal for Navy. Candido on the pitch. Untouched. Eric Roberts. Touchdown, Navy. As they've been doing throughout the season, the midshipmen make it look easy, moving down the field and taking the early lead. Extra point for Navy. Eric Rolfs will kick it. Craig Candido to hold it. And Matt Williams, the snapper. 14 plays, all of them on the ground. Rolfs now 33 of 34 on the season. 74-yard drive. It took up 6 minutes and 40 seconds. Roberts, the 1-yard touchdown. Navy in front. Navy leading possession. 7:12 mark, first quarter. The scoring drive looks like this. 14 plays, 74 yards. All of them were running plays.
And it couldn't be worse for Army. This is not the way you wanted to start the game. Your offense 3 and out. Your defense back on its heels, giving up a touchdown on the first series. I think if I were on the Army sideline, I would just be telling them, listen, you're not beaten until you admit it. Hence, don't admit it.
That sounds familiar.
Who said it?
Is that Patton?
General Patton said it. That's what I would be telling my Army guys on the sideline right now.
You are breaking out the early game quotes, and you've got a bunch of them.
Oh, I'll tell you,
I'm impressed.
Do a lot of reading, especially military reading.
Jeff Blumenfeld, the kicker, William White, the deep man. It takes a bounce, and Chuck Wilkie will return it. Wilkie emerging through a hole, but comes up shy of the 30-yard line as T.J. Costello helps make the play on special teams. 18-yard return. Black Knights offense will go back on the field, trailing 7-0 when we return. It's a game of patriotism and national pride. Navy leading Army 7-0. First quarter action here in Philadelphia. And we are fortunate to enhance our coverage this afternoon with Jeep Cam. Some wonderful pictures that we'll be bringing to you.
Yep. I thought that was a Webster grill or something flying around here.
Actually, it doubles up as a Webster grill.
Oh, it does. Okay.
If you're hungry at halftime, we can help you out. Carlton Jones in the backfield for
Army.
I'll
be hungry at halftime.
Oh, that much we know. First and 10 from the 28. And it's Jones looking for a hole, remaining on his feet, but still did not have the room to work with. A number of Navy players coming over to help make the play, including Brazier.
You know, you talk about Army and what they've dealt with, 0-12, and you would never know it by talking to the kids and what this game means to the kids. And then we say that they're kids, but yet you know, a year and a half from now, they might be stationed in harm's way. And we talked about that with every one of the Army cadets that we talked to, and they were just emphatic about servicing their country.
Well, when one of the players says to us, hey, I'd go to war with that guy, and he
really
means
meant it.
Literally, it's a little different than the normal conversations we're accustomed to. On second down, Domin, a deep drop. The flip to Jones makes a move at the 30-yard line. And able to get towards the sideline right around the 31. Eli Sanders, first man there, along with Ralph Henry. Have a sports fan on your shopping list? Get great gift ideas when you shop online at the official store of CBS Sportsline. And for a limited time, save big on select NCAA fan gear. Just click on shop at CBSSportsline.com. Tyler Robinson checks into the game behind Domin. Now Domin will work out of the shotgun. On a third and eight, Army having a tough time moving the football. Domin steps up, pump fake, and he is dropped. Zach Domin unable to get out of the clutches of Jeremy Chase, the sophomore from Norfolk, Virginia.
Take a look at this. Actually a pretty good pocket for Domin as he sits back there, and he's going to step up right here. He's got to let go of the football. Can't hold on to it that long. Offensive linemen need to know that the quarterback's going to get rid of the football. This is probably pretty much more of a coverage sack than it is a breakdown on the offensive line.
And the fourth sack of the season for Chase. Bradford will punt with Tomlinson standing at his own 41-yard line. Should be good field position once again for the midshipman. Bradford, left-footed punter. It comes off the side of his foot and rolls out of bounds, remaining in Army's territory. And Navy's going to have it at the 47. Just a 25-yard punt, and Navy already in front.
Pojďme do kina.
Kaiński siły lądowe pokonują marynarkę wojenną.
Sir, important message from our coalition friends.
Put it up on the big screen.
Go Army!
In any language, Army football is the best.
I've been impressed with their acting ability as well as their dedication.
Easy, bud.
Craig Candido, 6 touchdowns in last year's 58-12 victory over Army, takes over with excellent field position inside Army territory and a handoff to Kyle Eckel. And he gains 3 yards. For more on Craig Candido, let's go downstairs. Tracy Wolfson.
Thanks, Ian. Quarterback Craig Candido's hero is not Donovan McNabb. It's not Brett Favre. It's his uncle, Russell Sanborn. Sanborn, who is in the stands today, was a prisoner of war during Operation Desert Storm in 1991 and was held captive for 26 days. In honor of his uncle, Candido is wearing his VMA 542 patch on his uniform today. And he is dedicating this game to Sanborn, who is set to go back to Iraq next spring. Back to you guys.
All right, thanks very much, Tracy. Frank Divis hit by Brian Hill, a big hit, and Candido, I think, knows the difference between football pressure and real pressure through the stories from his uncle.
Well, they all do, you know, and that's the thing. All of these young men have a 5-year commitment to their service, and basically it's an amazing thing when you talk to them and you listen to the stories and the reality that they bring you back to, and that's what's going on around the world today, and that football is really just kind of a hobby.
Third and 7, Candido unable to get outside because of Odine Brathwaite. Excellent pursuit. And a loss of 4. Give Brathwaite a sack on the play.
Take a look at Candido right here. He's going to roll to his left, and Brathwaite's just going to string it out, and he's going to get away and make a nice tackle. Eric Roberts was there to block him, but Roberts, you know, at 5'10", 193, Brathwaite should be able to run over him.
And they force Navy into a punt. John Skaggs, who has been a record-breaking punter for the midshipmen throughout his career, punting to Ray Stiff. And he'll throw it on the fake. Short throw. It is caught. Vaughn Kelly, no, they wave it off. He trapped it.
I got to tell you something, Brian. I mean, Ian, the Navy punt team read the defense perfectly because Army brought one of their spies down inside, and that left wide open. And all he has to do is just throw it a little bit further.
Mm-hmm.
and they have a first down. So Army catches their first break of the game, and they have great field position on their own 49-yard line.
Vaughn Kelly, a very confident cornerback. We had a chance to sit down with him, and he said, I have to be ready to play any position along the secondary. Little did he know he had to be ready to catch the football on a fake punt.
A little bit better throw, he would have made the catch.
49-yard line, that's where Army takes over. Carlton Jones by himself in the backfield. Little trick by them. Mason, he'll run it. Crossing midfield, and Mason's got a first down for the Black Knights. Fifth rush of the season for Lamar Mason, 12 yards. As we go to New York, check in with Tim Brando.
All right, Ian and Boomer, a very big BCS implication game. The Beavers of Oregon State, after a 90-yard pass, get a touchdown run from Steven Jackson, but Matt Leinart answers, finding his favorite target for the 15th time this year. Mike Williams, that's a school record for touchdown receptions, 7-all, Ian.
L.P. Carroll trying to keep his team alive for a national title out on the West Coast as Jones gets the call and Navy is ready. Eddie Carthen, the senior co-captain from Donaldsville, Georgia, a four-year starter at linebacker, makes the stop.
Then you go back to that fake punt by Navy. It was perfectly read defense. They do everything that they're supposed to do. They just don't execute the play. And the question that I would have is, why would Army leave a guy like that so wide open and expect not the other team not to throw it? Doesn't make any sense to me.
On a second and eight from the 37, winding down here in the first quarter, under 3 minutes to go. And a whistle. It's been well played so far. Very clean game. Flag down.
Snap infraction on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat second down.
Alberto Riveron, our referee here today. Sunday, television's most watched new drama. It's Cold Case. An anonymous caller confesses to a 14-year-old murder. Who is he and why is he telling police now? Detective Lily Rush is about to uncover the truth. Don't miss an all-new Cold Case Sunday at 8, 7 Central, here on CBS.
Don't get Detective Lily Rush all upset. She'll come after you.
She's tough.
She is tough.
I've watched the program. On a second and 13. Dahman. He's going to keep it. And Dahman. Tough QB taking that hit. A 6-yard gain. Lane Jackson dishing out the punishment. The junior linebacker from Miami, Florida. Now starting on the inside. He was playing on the outside until the Air Force game, and they were impressed with the way he performed inside.
And you were talking about Dahman. You were talking about how tough he is. And Joe Glover, the left tackle, was telling us that, well, we have a nickname for Dahman, and that's Opie. Because of
why? Why?
Well, why? Just take a good look at him.
I'm not sure Dahman shaves, but he can throw. And a first down makes the connection to Aaron Alexander. A 10-yard gain through the air. David Mahoney, the linebacker, makes the stop, and Army is on the move.
You know, they say that you can't get a good kind of athlete here at one of these academies because of, you know, what it takes to get into the school. But you take a look at Aaron Alexander. He's 6'6", 200 pounds. I mean, that's a big-time wide receiver right there.
High school basketball player, junior from Louisiana, has given the Black Knights a first down inside the 30-yard line. On the handoff, Carlton Jones leaves his feet and hurdles his way to the 17. Good block by Seth Neiman, creating some extra room. A 9-yard gain for Jones.
Take a look at these holes on the left side of the offensive line here. Just a little trap pull right there by Adrian Milojic as he leads right around there. And I'll tell you what, it's all about confidence. And right now, Army's got a little confidence. And if you're Navy, that's the last thing that you want the underdog to have in this game.
Running the football has been a major problem for this Army team throughout the season. Under a minute to go on the first. Second and one now for Army. They are in the red zone. Make the initial handoff. Give it to Mason. Juke move, and Mason crosses the 15-yard line. Eli Sanders cuts him down low. Limits him to a gain of 4, but another first down for the Black Knights.
So now offensive coordinator John Bond is in a little bit of a rhythm with Dahman in this offense. They're able to run it up inside. They'll be able to run some reverses, a little bit more emotion shown by the Army players, and all of a sudden, you know, now he can open up his playbook and he can be a little bit more aggressive. This is exactly what Army needed at this point in the game.
Well, and what's the turning point, at least so far? The fake punt that went awry. Three receivers set. Almost picked off. Very dangerous as Jeremy Chase got his hands on the football.
All of that emotion could have went right out of the stadium for Army on one play, but Jeremy Chase right there, 49, he sees it. As he tries to get cut at the line of scrimmage, almost makes the play right there to take this emotion away from Army.
Chase, the sophomore, older brother Nate, is an offensive lineman on the team. Talented family. On second and 10. Jones makes his cut, and Jones working hard to bring it to the 5. 8-yard gain, that will be the final play of this first quarter. Navy with a 7-0 lead on Army, but the Black Knights are driving. End of the first quarter. Midshipman up 7-0 will return to Philadelphia after this message and a word from your local station. Start of the second quarter, Ian Eagle, Boomer Esiason, Tracy Wolfson, Dwayne Ballin, our entire CBS crew. John Mumford, the interim head coach, took over for Todd Berry, who was let go on October 13th. Army looking for the equalizer, trailing 7-0. 3rd and 2 from the Navy 5. Handed off to Jones, the pile being pushed inside the 3-yard line as Lane Jackson was given credit for the stop, and a first down for Army. 1st and goal.
You know, when you have the best rushing team in football and in the NCAA, as Navy has, you wonder how good is the defense. You know, they're not on the field quite a bit. so now I guess we're finding out that Army probably feels like, you know, we can play with these guys. This is not Hawaii. This is not Cincinnati. This is a team that looks just like us.
On the handoff, Jones stretching for the goal line in a big formation. They had 2 tight ends on the field. And he comes up just short. 2nd and goal upcoming for the Black Knights as Bobby McLaren helps make the stop. Well, Paul Johnson's defense has improved, though, from a year ago, and a lot of the defensive players telling us, yes, scheme has been part of it, but the attitude is completely different.
And I think, to me, defense is all about attitude. It's about hustle. It's about getting after the football and not giving up. And certainly when you talk to the Navy defenders, they tell you that's the way they feel right now.
2nd and goal from the 1. They didn't get there. Navy like a brick wall, including DeJuan Price, as Jones is denied. No gain on the play.
Again, down on the goal line, it's about displacing that line of scrimmage and moving back. Woo! And I'll tell you, look at McLaren get up in there, number 51. Watch this. That's how you hit the hole right there when you're a defensive linebacker.
12th play of the drive. 3rd and goal for Army. Trailing 7-0. Dobbin on the pitch. Does Jones have the room? Yes, he does. Touchdown, Army.
That kind of looked like a play out of the offensive playbook of the Navy. A little option. Dobbin just flips it out to Jones. Looks like Navy's a little bit surprised on defense, but I go back. Take a look at this formation right here. Dobbin comes down. Poised. Just flip it out to Jones. Let him run to the sideline. And they, all of a sudden, Army's back in the game, and I think a lot of it goes right back to that failed fake punt attempt by Navy.
6th rushing touchdown of the season for the sophomore from Henderson, North Carolina. Extra point, they couldn't get it off, and Wesley Willard, the holder, is surrounded. And if that doesn't tell the story of this Army football season, I don't know what does. They are successful driving down the field and then cannot complete the point after. Jones gets Army on the board, but the extra point denied. Navy holds on to a 7-6 lead in the second. Is it an apple for Army as the Black Knights put some points on the board, take advantage of good field position, and then move it down the field, 51 yards, 12 plays. Jones, the 1 yard touchdown run, but they did not get the extra point and they trailed 7-6.
You know, plays like that botched extra point are what get coaches fired. And a lot of mistakes made by Army this season, botched center quarterback snaps and plays like that. You know, and the alumni and everybody else gets a little bit dicey about, you know, just the basics right. of football have to be executed. When you can't do that, then all of a sudden they feel like a change needs to be made.
Austin Miller on the kickoff. McGown, the return man. And he wants to run it out. 2 yards deep of the end zone. Takes it out across the 20-yard line. And moves it ahead just short of the 24. Rob Davis, first man there. Time to go to New York. Let's check in with Tim Brando.
All right, Ian, Matt Leinart, who has certainly had a great year for Norm Chow, the offensive coordinator at USC, here to Reggie Bush, one of the trio of backs coming out of the backfield to make the catch. 14-7, SC leading Oregon State. The Beavers missed a field goal try.
You lose the Heisman Trophy winner, and you're still a national championship contention. Not a bad situation at USC.
Pete Carroll's in the right spot. You know, I had him as a year for a head coach with the Jets back in 1994. Terrific football coach and a difference maker at the college level.
Handoff, Echol. Army players draped all over the fullback, Greg Washington included. The inside linebacker, a gain of one on the play. Well, Kurt Daniels, the junior from Leawood, Kansas, is a difference maker on this defense. His brother Clay was a three-year letterman at defensive back. And that was one of the reasons why Kurt ended up attending West Point. Felt it was the right situation for him. Candido is driven back by Mike Clark. Clark making an outstanding play. And for more on Daniels, let's go downstairs. Bring in Dwayne Ballant.
And you mentioned Kurt's brother, Clay. In 2000, he had an opportunity to play in this game. He had an injured leg, but the coach allowed him to play in the game, and he played in it. He and Kurt were very close. They keep in touch with each other via email. He did not encourage Kurt to attend here, but once he did, he said, I'm very proud of you. And Kurt wears the 101st patch in honor of his brother, and he would be very proud of this defense right now.
Well, his brother Clay is in Iraq, and they have talked on the phone twice, last time over Thanksgiving. And as Dwayne mentioned, they are in contact via email. The Home Depot coach's decision, take it back, 1999. Daniels, a left leg injury, a broken leg, and Bob Sutton decided to let him play because Clay so desperately wanted to end his career on the field. He played the final play of the game. Army holds the intimidating Navy offense as Stiff, the return man, jumps in the air and takes it to the 40-yard line. So the Black Knights of Army, not only competitive, but with a chance now to potentially take the lead after the 46-yard punt and 9-yard return. We'll come back. More second quarter action from the Lincoln Philly after this.
Don't miss Cold Case, TV's most watched new drama, Sundays on CBS.
We don't sell snacks, we don't sell cars, and we're not a department store. But we sure know how to sell tires. Pomp's Tire and Auto Service, serving you with a professional staff that will help you put the right tires on your vehicle. We have the largest inventory in the Midwest, featuring Kelly, Michelin, Firestone, Bridgestone, Dunlop, and BF Goodrich. We've been in the tire business since 1939. We know tires. You should know Pomp's.
Jimbo! Hey! How's the weather?
No, I'm making a smoothie.
With AT&T One Rate USA, you can make all the calls you want from home for one flat rate.
I would expect the same from...
It's the phone plan that encourages you to talk.
No, it's the blender. No, the blender.
I hate the desert.
And talk.
Oh, my goodness. When did that happen?
And talk.
How long have you guys been dating?
Call anyone, anywhere in the country, whenever you want.
What?
It's all for one flat monthly rate with your choice of calling features.
No, I'm just coming in. I gotta go clean up. This place is a wreck.
Call 1-800-ATT-4ALL to sign up. AT&T One Rate USA. It's the perfect plan for those who like to take advantage of a good thing. Or in this case, your mother's good thing.
High School Sports Extra, tonight at 10:35.
Army at 0-12, their worst season in their 114-year football history, and trying to avoid becoming the first team in Division I football history to go 0-13 in a season. They trail right now 7-6 to Navy, but they've got the football after the Army defense came up big.
Well, you talk to these Army seniors, they tell you that they want to leave West Point with a good taste in their mouth, and a win here today would do that for them. And for the younger players, they all say, listen, we got to start getting ready for next year, and this would give us a nice boost into the offseason.
Only 10 seniors on this Army roster, 35 juniors. Dahman, the quarterback, is only a sophomore. On the floater to Jones. Incomplete. Carlton Jones unable to haul it in. So many great stories when you talk to both of these teams. We chatted with left tackle Joel Glover, and Boomer, you asked him about how his mom reacted when he told her the news that he was coming to West Point.
Well, tears of sadness and also pride. And I think he said to us both, he said, well, you know, she was losing her baby. I was like, wait, you're her baby? Oh, my goodness. And look at him. He's 6'5", 291 pounds. He's a little bit bigger than a baby, but I can understand where he's coming from.
No military background, but he did have G.I. Joes growing up. That was the closest connection. With the Kung Fu grip, William White is tossed down along the sideline by David Mahoney. A loss of three.
And I'm sure Buddy Green, the Navy defensive coordinator, gave his fellows a little talking to on the sideline, because they're coming out a little bit more spirited now for this particular series. But you know, when you talk to these guys and you listen to what they say, I can't tell you. I just had such a great sense of pride knowing that these folks are going to be the next line of defense, you know, protecting our country. And when you leave both of the academies, you just feel really good about the future and whose hands it's going to be in.
And this game provides a brief diversion for so many members of our military stationed across the world. Bragging rights on the line until next year. Dahman slings it out to the sideline and incomplete. Walter Hill was down there with DeJuan Price defending as we check in with New York and Tim Brando.
All right, Ian and Boomer, well, playing in the shadow of a bad team all year, Walter Reyes is our Verizon Wireless top performer of the day. He had 19 carries for 189 yards, 5 touchdowns, a very significant win for the BCS because USC takes a strength of schedule hit with Notre Dame losing by a wide margin, fella.
Syracuse getting the win over Notre Dame.
I don't know what's more confusing, the BCS or the quarterback rating of the NFL.
Yeah, I'm going to ask you about both in the second half, so if you have some time to study. Alex Bradford on the punt. And Tomlinson will let it bounce. It does take an Army roll. Comes up just short of the 15-yard line, a 46-yard boot. And the Black Knights able to pin the midshipmen back in their own territory. Navy with a 7-6 lead over Army. To this year's game, Navy has a chance to win the Commander-in-Chief Trophy. It would be their first outright title since 1981. That's the annual round-robin competition between all three service academies, including Air Force. Navy beat Air Force back in October, 28-25. At a first and 10 for Navy. Great first drive. They've been struggling since. Candido on the pitch to Roberts. Down the sideline, Roberts. Strong run on first down. He picks up 11, and they'll move the chains. Hill and Brewer able to force him out of bounds.
And talking to the defensive coaches of Army, they said all of the big, well, not all of them, but most of the big plays come outside on the pitch. So you have to be very careful not to get lulled to sleep inside, paying so much attention to that fullback. When you talk to the defensive players, Daniels and Ryan Kent of the Army, they tell you, just stay at home, read your keys, and don't get sucked in and fooled by Candido in the backfield.
On the rollout, connection is made to Tony Lane, another one of those talented slot back players for Navy. And Candido actually throwing it. 8 yards. His first pass of the afternoon, Barrett Scruggs making the play defensively, sets up second and two. Well, for Navy, this is actually the youngest team in school history. They are dressing 23 freshmen and playing 11, which bodes well for the future of this program.
No, and Candido told us, he said, this senior class wants to set Navy's program up for the future. They did that this year, 7-4 coming into this game, heading to the Houston Bowl.
Candido, the pitch. Eric Roberts has some room. Roberts cutting it to the outside and angled out of bounds in Army territory. Amir Jenkins helping with a block, the receiver. And he picks up 19 yards on the run.
So many different looks that this Navy offense gives you. Eccles in the middle. No, he doesn't have it. Candido comes down. The end takes him, and then he takes off and pitches it outside to Roberts. And again, if you're an Army defender, you have to stay where you're supposed to be. Don't look into the backfield, and don't get fooled by the ball handling skills of Candido.
Four carries, 38 yards. Roberts averages 9.6 yards per carry. This is Eccles. Kyle Eccles, the bruising fullback. And he keeps this drive going with a 10-yard gain. Green and Gooden up front on that offensive line helped to spring him loose.
Now, so much for not blocking. At least that's what Paul Johnson told me, his offensive line. They said, well, we don't really block anybody. Well, I think they're blocking some people, don't you, Ian? They're opening up holes, and Eccles is a force to be reckoned with. As you said, he loves to play the game like John Riggins. Lower center of body, of balance, lowering that shoulder, taking on oncoming tacklers and just trying to run and bowl people over. And if there were ever a fullback, this man right here is the quintessential fullback type. You talk to him, you see him, you see how thick his neck is and how big his shoulders are. That's my fullback.
Listed at 5'11", 235 pounds. You saw Ryan Kent, the playmaker on this defense, walking off. Impact player, energy player, the senior from Woodbury, New Jersey. This is Eccles once again. Kyle Eccles up the middle for 8. Coming up next, big-time bowl bids, postseason glory at stake. David Green, the Bulldogs tangle with Matt Mock. And the Bayou Bengals of LSU. Georgia LSU SEC championship presented by Dr. Pepper. Green and Mock having terrific seasons. Mock very prolific with 27 touchdowns. Taylor Justice has stepped in to replace Ryan Kent, who was shaken up. This is a 2nd-and-2 for Navy. And this time, Eccles doesn't have the room. Washington and Clark combining.
You know, the interesting thing coming into this game, Ian, you and I were talking about it, because Navy loves to run the ball so much, that first quarter just flew by. I mean, it went by so quick, and that's exactly what you would want if you were Army. Just kind of give them the yards, that's fine. Just don't give them the points. For this Army defense, you know, you can bend. Just don't break into allowing Navy to get a touchdown. And, you know, the clock's going to go, and you want to shorten the game if you're Army at this point.
Now, Navy has 122 yards rushing. They had 530 in their win over Central Michigan a couple of weeks ago. Eccles, 3-yard gain and a first down. Just about everybody involved defensively for the Black Knights.
And because they don't run out of bounds, and because they do hand it off to Eccles so much, the clock just continues to run. You know, I remember playing against some better teams. We always went in thinking that if we could run the ball, control the game, and slow the clock down a little bit, we can keep the opponent's team's offense off the field. The Navy's actually does that for themselves, but
now a 1st-and-10. And guess who? Kyle Eccles, 2-yard gain. Michael Brimage getting the nod on that play.
But what I was going to say, but what they've been able to do this year is score points. And last week, or their last time out against Central Michigan, Craig Candido was on the field for 8 possessions. They scored 8 touchdowns.
Now, you played a lot of football.
I've never done that. Never been a part of that.
8 touchdowns.
I've never seen anything like it. And when you look at the film, it was almost like there was nobody else on the field playing against them. I mean, it was a clinic.
63 points, the most the Navy has scored since 96, when they scored 64 versus Duke. Candido keeping it himself, and Odine Brathwaite, who had the sack earlier, smart player, junior from Miami, Florida. He sat out his freshman season to concentrate on his academics, and that's another variable here, Boomer, that you have to talk about, the high standards and the pressure that these student athletes face. These are true student athletes.
Well, you want to talk about priorities. This Army team flying to Hawaii Well, the sophomores on that plane had a math test that they were required to take. And not only the football players, but the cheerleaders as well. Everybody who was a sophomore on that plane was taking a math test.
Here's Candido. On the option, Roberts. Dragged down. Excellent play by Kurt Daniels, a loss of two. The engineering psychology major makes the stop.
Well, this is what you want to do if you're Army on defense. Get in the backfield, push everybody back, string it out to the sideline. Roberts has nowhere to go. So a nice play by the Army defense, and that's exactly what you want to do. You want to hold, make them settle for a field goal attempt right here.
38-yard field goal attempt for Eric Rolfs. He has made six straight field goals. Make it seven. He nails a 38-yarder to add to Navy's lead, 10-6, midshipmen here in the second quarter. We're coming back.
I joined the Navy because I had a plan.
Leader of our soldiers in Iraq.
Navy 10, Army 6, 5:22 to play in the first half here in Philadelphia. Scoring drive for the midshipmen. Army able to hold them to a field goal. Eric Rolfs connects from 38 yards away. 11 plays, 62 yards. Again, doing it mostly on the ground. We did see Candido actually put the ball in the air once.
But I think if you're Army right now, this is a very important part of the game. 5:22 left to go in the second quarter, and you don't want the game to get out of hand. So your offense, your special teams have got to get your field position, got to eat some of that clock up. And especially, you cannot turn the ball over here and keep the momentum on the Navy sideline. You know, and this is what happens in every football game. There are certain situations that you look at and you say, you know what? This is the point in the game where we have to be able to sustain an offensive drive to take some of that momentum away from our opponent.
William White is the deep man. He does have a 67-yard return this year. Doesn't have a touchdown. He told us that he's about ready to bust loose. He'll get his chance from the four. White, not on this play, driven back and comes up short of the 15-yard line. Wayne Irons making the stick on special teams. Coming up Sunday on CBS, when an FBI agent hides his star witness at his mom's house, there'll be no peace on earth. Emmy winner Tyne Daly and Jamie Gert star in Undercover Christmas. That's Sunday at 9, 8 Central on CBS. Average yards gained on first down. Navy has done the trick. Just under 7 yards per clip. Army hovering at 3 yards on first down. Carlton Jones. Shalamar Brazier, the senior from Detroit, Michigan. A city track champion in the Motor City and a very solid tackler.
Yeah, Brazier just coming off the end of the line of scrimmage right here, coming right through and making a tackle in the backfield. So a nice read by the defender for Navy. And you know, the interesting thing was the formation. Three wide receivers lined up in a line up at the top of the screen. I guess that was what you would call a decoy, I guess.
Didn't work. On a second and 10. Jones gets the call again, this time to the other side. Jones, little bit of running room. Navy able to catch up to him. A 5-yard gain. Chase living up to his last name as he chases him down. And a little bit shaken up.
Were you thinking about that last night?
No, it just came to me.
Just came to you?
Yeah.
You're good.
Very quick. Thank you. Coming up, Earthlink halftime report. Tim Brando, Spencer Tim, and we'll get you caught up on today's action. They'll introduce you to Army Second Lieutenant Chad Jenkins. Terrific story. In 2 years, he's gone from gridiron hero to something much bigger. One of our American heroes stationed in Iraq. That's coming up on the Earthlink halftime report. Third and 5, a four receiver formation. They stack it to the right side. Instead, go to the other side. Breaking tackles, William White, but he comes up short of the first down. A 3-yard gain for the junior from Virginia Beach.
Well, they had that formation again. This time the receivers were lined up one behind the other on the bottom of the screen, and they threw a wide receiver screen to the top, and Bobby McLaren, number 51, the linebacker for Navy, read the play perfectly and wasn't you know, out of position. He was right there to make the play.
And this is exactly what you talked about. Army not only needed to do something positive with this drive, but at the very least use up clock. Navy, a big play offense, will get it back. Good field position. Tomlinson stumbles backwards. And Tomlinson is now thrown down. The ball is loose along the sideline. And they rule it down at the 49-yard line. Four-yard return. Brent McCorkle makes the stop on special teams. Now, looking back on history, and there is so much history, 64th Army-Navy game back in 63, and look at all of the things that took place. Pentagon postponed the game after the death of John F. Kennedy. Our president, Roger Staubach, leads Navy to the victory. The first instant replay used by CBS, something that has become a staple in television sports coverage. Just over 3 minutes to go in the second quarter. Candido keeping it himself, and Mike Clark read it perfectly. The junior from Florida, Lake Wales, excellent athlete and very good instincts to make that play.
Instincts, the key word right there, because Mike Clark came down the backside of the defense of the offense of the line of scrimmage, and ran down Candido and did not stop. So he realized that the play was going away. He was the one guy that wasn't blocked on the backside and made the play.
Second and seven. 2:28 and the clock is ticking here in the first half. Rollout, Candido throwing the long ball downfield, and Lionel Wesley cannot catch up to it. Delente Brewer in on the coverage. Last season's meeting, Giant Stadium in New Jersey. Craig Candido, well, he was living a dream. Candido turned in one of the greatest individual performances in the history of Army Navy. A school record, 6 touchdowns. Midshipman in a romp, 58-12. Over Army. And they remember. Army remembers.
Oh, they remember.
Third down conversions. 3 out of 7 for Navy. Candido throwing to the sideline. Roberts hauls it in. And a first down for the midshipman. Out near the 36-yard line.
It's a little rollout by Candido to the right. And a two-man pattern. Roberts to the outside. He reads it perfectly. The defenders have to get out underneath the wide receiver. You can't get hung up inside. And right there, Brian Hill, the inside linebacker. And also, you know, you have to kind of get underneath those throws. You can't allow that kind of separation, and you can't allow that kind of view from the quarterback standpoint.
Army takes a timeout, each team with 2 remaining. Navy looking for more points before we hit the break in Philadelphia. Detective Lily Rush, 8, 7 Central, here on CBS. First and 10 after the Army timeout. Kyle Echol carries and comes up shy of the 30-yard line. Michael Resnick combining with Mike Clark, a gain of 6. How about this field? How is it holding up after all the weather conditions that we've experienced over the last day and a half here in Philly?
I'll tell you what, I think the Philadelphia people here, the operations people at the stadium, have done a wonderful job. Now, remember, they have a game tomorrow here between the Cowboys and the Eagles, so that will be the real test. What is it going to be like for tomorrow's game?
They do have a heating system underneath the field. They've kept the temperature at 70 degrees as Candido carries himself, and Brian Hill was ready for it. He'll be close to a first down. This is tape from earlier this morning. They had the field covered, and that was the snowfall that we experienced earlier today. I'd say right around 2:30 Eastern, the snow stopped, and they kept the tarp on, eventually took it off, and the field in good shape as we have another timeout in Philly. In Annapolis. On 3rd and 1, Echols got the first down.
This ought to be interesting, the 2-minute drill for Navy. You know, they run the spread offense, but it really is the triple option. We'll watch Craig Candido right now go through his 2-minute drill and his mental gymnastics.
Coming up on 1 minute to play, second quarter. Candido puts some touch on it to Roberts, and it's ruled incomplete. Stretching for the football, unable to grab it.
Again, Roberts wide open. This is the play that they ran earlier that they completed for a first down. Again, nobody underneath Roberts. It's a nice attempt by Roberts, but clearly incomplete.
We talked to Eric Roberts, asked him, would you rather play in the snow or the rain? He's a native of Florida. He said, oh, yeah, snow, absolutely. I said, how many times have you played in the snow? He said, never. So how can you say
this? Give it a shot. It looks like it'd be a lot of fun.
Yeah,
right?
Seems like it would be better than the rain. That's the confidence that you get from the midshipmen and the cadets. Candido thrown down by Washington. First sack of the season for Greg Washington, the junior from Fayetteville, North Carolina.
They went back to the same play again, and this time Tarver gets underneath the receiver Roberts, and Candido has nowhere to throw the football. So three times they went back to that play, and that last time it was finally covered by Army in the secondary.
And it sets up a third and 12, 36 seconds left. Roll out, stop and throw by Candido. Coming back for it, Mick Yokaitis. Incomplete. So the Army defense has done an outstanding job against this high-powered Navy offense in the first half for head coach John Mumford.
You know, give them some yards, fine, but when you get down inside the red zone or inside your 30-yard line, just kind of bend but don't break. Try to make some plays. That's exactly what they did on that last series, and force them to settle for a field goal attempt to keep the game close.
41-yarder for the senior from Oklahoma, Eric Rolfs. Again, Candido will hold it. Looking to go two out of two today, and Rolfs, he's got it. Flag down, thrown at the 25-yard line. Maybe a premature celebration by Rolfs. Army, the interested party right now.
There was some movement inside on the offensive line, and it was against Army. You're going to decline it if you are Paul Johnson. That's the appropriate thing to do.
Offside.
Field goal is good.
Defense. Penalty is declined. Field goal is good.
Only the second flag thrown today. Johnson's going to keep the points. And the lead is 13-6 for the midshipmen to the Houston Bowl. Bowl game since the Aloha Bowl they went to back in 96. White on the return, initially from the 5 and running into a crowd. Comes up short of the 20-yard line. TJ Costello again making the play on special teams for the Naval Academy. A 15-yard return.
And you mentioned that Aloha Bowl. That's the game that Navy won. And the offense coordinator for Navy was Paul Johnson. And remember who they beat? They beat California. Remember who the head coach for California was?
I think it's a familiar name to NFL fans.
Steve Mariucci.
And Johnson was able to bring back the pride and credibility to this Navy program when he was rehired as the head coach.
He brought it back all in 1 year, this year.
Yeah. He said that's been the fun part around Annapolis, to see people react to the football team with respect and pride, something that was missing 1 year ago. Also a year ago, Navy blew out Army. Not the case so far today. Army hanging around at the end of the first half, 13-6. Navy in front. Let's go downstairs to Tracy Wolfson.
Thanks a lot, Coach. Army is playing with a lot of intensity. It's just a 7-point game. What will you do to try and start converting these drives into touchdowns?
Well, we just got to execute. We're killing ourselves. We must, two out of every three plays, we're busting and blocking the wrong guy. They're playing hard, but we can play a lot better than that. We will in the second half.
Good luck, Coach.
All right, Tracy, Coach, thanks very much. Navy with a 13-6 lead at the half as we go back to our New York studio and welcome in Tim Brandon.
Thanks, Ian. Coming up on the Earthlink Halftime Report, Spencer and I will have all of today's scores and highlights, including, is USC starting to taste sugar? We'll let you know after this word from your local station.
Internet tools and services.
Halftime Report. I'm Tim Brandon with a score in Philadelphia. Navy leading Army by a score of 13-6. Spencer Tillman joins me now. And Spencer, Navy playing on the ground like a team that really is destined for a bowl season.
Well, I think the thing that's encouraging, though, the Black Knights are keeping them to their season average around 141 at the halftime. That's a good thing. The score's close enough. Look for them to rebound in the second half. We've got a ball game on our
hands. No doubt. USC looking to build a case for a trip to New Orleans against Oregon State today. And Oregon's The Beavers get it done with Steven Jackson taking the ball in. This was after a 90-yard pass completion to open the game. And then Matt Leinart finds Mike Williams open again, his 15th touchdown catch of the year, a school record. That tied the game at 7. Again, after the Beavers turn it over for a second time, Reggie Bush, 30 yards. And again, the Beavers, 94th in turnover margin, USC second in the country at 1.5 plus ahead. You look at the BCS top three scenario. The thing to remember here is Oklahoma can afford a loss tonight to Kansas State in the Big 12 title game and still have enough distance to make sure that they're in the Sugar Bowl.
Yeah, but you know, at the end of the day, you talk about bridging the gap. The big problem with that last graphic is this. Typically, the timing of that particular loss matters big time. Not this year. No reason to worry about it if you're Oklahoma. You're still going to be.
LSU, by the way, has moved up 6.5 points and 1.5 per week. So they've still a lot to play for. Obviously, much more to talk about, including a matchup with Notre Dame and Syracuse that had a tremendous impact today on LSU, because strength of schedule goes away from USC, and Walter Reyes was going away all day.
Walter Reyes, a big back, 19 carries, 189 yards, 5 touchdowns, record-setting performance today.
No doubt about it. Big, big day for him. And the holiday season is here for a great selection of college fan gear from over 100 schools. Visit the shop at CBSSportsLine.com. And once again, coming up at 8 o'clock Eastern, the SEC Championship presented by Dr. Pepper. It's number 5 Georgia and 3rd-ranked LSU. And Spencer, how do you break this game down?
Well, I think at the end of the day, you got to look at David Green. He's got to handle the blitz packages he's going to face from this big-time defense. He's watched the edges coming off last time they played. Watch the sneaky corner cat blitz here. You're going to have the safety coming high out of the hole. That's trouble. A-gap, B-gap, 3-4, weak side. That is Nick Saban deluxe. David Green has got to manage this pressure. He's going to see it early and often today. They'll be all over him.
All right. Well, coming up, the story of Chad Jenkins. He was once a gridiron hero at West Point as a cadet. Now he's an American hero as a soldier in Iraq. That when the EarthLink halftime report continues.
I'm wanted in 4 states.
Stats. That's all. Total yards with Navy, but Army hanging in, as Spencer mentioned just a moment ago. Now, reminder, an NFL doubleheader tomorrow. In the first game, most of you will see the Colts and the Titans. Then later, many will see the Chiefs and the Broncos. And it all begins at noon Eastern with the NFL Today.
Army-Navy is especially meaningful for the seniors in both academies. It's the last time when the only thing at stake are bragging rights. 2 years ago, Army quarterback Chad Jenkins reveled in that moment. Now, Second Lieutenant Jenkins is an entirely different kind of hero.
It's kind of like before games, when you roll out of the wire here, you get that kind of anxious, ready to go. It's a lot similar to being a quarterback on the field, because you're basically in charge of whatever the platoon fails or executes.
Before stepping foot in Iraq, Chad Jenkins had what it took to be a leader. In 2001, playing with a torn ACL, he inspired Army to victory over Navy in his final college game.
Chad was maybe the best leader that I've ever been around, just because if you didn't want to come, he would physically drag you along.
He's the youngest of 3, so you would think that he would tend to follow rather than lead. But even as a young child, I mean, he sort of set the course and decide what he, you know, wanted to do, and then he would follow through with it.
Jenkins was set to return to West Point as a graduate assistant. But after 9/11, he signed on for active duty. Today, he's stationed in Fallujah, one of the war's hottest danger zones. He's the platoon commander in charge of 37 men who depend on his leadership. We're not talking about touchdown drives here. Their lives are in his hands.
I got guys that are 18, 19 years old in my platoon, and I mean, this is a stressful environment. This is probably more stressful than if it was a conventional war, because you know who the enemy is, you know who you're going after in that type of environment. Here, every time you roll out, you don't know who's the bad guy.
When we used to go watch Chad play, of course, we worried about what he was doing on the field as far as getting hurt, and we always worried about that. Well, that doesn't compare to what our worries are now.
I can't imagine for him. I can't imagine for any man or woman who's over there, because the sense is that sometimes it can be horrific.
Last month, a helicopter was shot down, killing 16 Americans. And Jenkins' platoon was first on the scene. After helping rescue and evacuate survivors, he and his men spent 5 days in hostile conditions, defending the wreckage from looters.
Our biggest concern was getting those people out of the wreckage and getting them on birds so that they would have a chance to make it. Just a horrible event, something that you train for, but you just hope your guys never have to go through, just because it was just a hard day in general.
I'm sure that it's something that'll probably change him, you know, to experience something like that. That's not something that most people have to deal with in this lifetime, but he always had a positive outlook, and he was always more concerned about how we handled it versus how he was handling it.
He chose to serve his country, and I'm grateful for that, and I think the rest of America is grateful that we have people like Chad who are willing to do that.
Emily and my family, that's the biggest thing, because no matter where you are, your home's where your family is. Your loved ones, you know, those are the ones, especially around this time of year, that you want to be with, and that's the hardest thing.
Today, 10 West Point graduates have lost their lives in global war, and you know, Tim, Chad Jenkins is a great story, question about that, but it's just one of so many over there.
No doubt about it, and you know, you look at that shot of him throwing the football, Spencer, you know, he has to be lost in his memory of playing the game now that the reality of life is far more important. We thank you for watching the EarthLink Halftime Report. Coming up, the second half of Army-Navy.
The EarthLink Halftime Report is sponsored by EarthLink. EarthLink revolves around you with internet tools and services you want.
I moved to EarthLink because they hate internet pollution as much as I do.
I moved because they block pop-ups. And I'll take all the help I can get.
Because Spam Blocker keeps my inbox neat and clean.
Different people, different passions, different reasons for moving to EarthLink. Like our pop-up blocker and spam blocker tools. They block almost all pop-ups and spam. Call 1-800-EARTHLINK. Get 6 months of dial-up service featuring EarthLink Accelerator at half price. Move to EarthLink. It revolves around you.
Come on, people now.
During Red Lobster's Create Your Own Seafood Feast, you can bring together the best gifts of the sea. Choose from 10 tempting entrees. Combine two or three and create a feast that celebrates the season. Now at Red Lobster.
I don't want to get married to a boy. Be all weird. Your parents start crying in the aisles. And they make a big scene. And then, like, there'd be a river of cries, like, right in the middle of the aisle. And everybody would start crying. I just prefer a wedding dress.
Mike, Sue.
Yes.
Love and honor.
Yep.
Sickness, health.
Uh-huh.
Objections? Rings? Do you?
I do.
Do you?
I do.
Kiss? Husband and wife. Next.
Next on Walkie-Talkies, get it done.
Stronger. More comfortable. Guaranteed. Wrangler 5-star premium quality denim. Wrangler. Real comfortable jeans.
The United States Naval Academy, established in 1845.
Getting you ready for second half action here in Philadelphia, Navy 13, Army 6. We welcome you back. Ian Eagle, Boomer Esiason, rejoining you here in the broadcast booth. A couple things coming into this game. Turnovers. Army led the nation in turnovers heading into action. 42.
They don't have any.
They have none, and their defense has certainly stepped up. They've kept it competitive, but unlike a year ago.
But you really feel like Navy is going to take over here any minute now. 40 offensive plays, and one of the reasons that you're so close right now is you've been able to shut down Craig Candido, the guy who had 6 touchdowns against you last year right there. And these next 2 plays are on third down, big sacks by Army. And finally covering this play here where Washington can get back in the backfield and knock down Candido. So if you ask me, you just feel like the momentum is for Navy, and Army is just hanging on.
Look at the halftime numbers, and yes, the numbers favor Navy. much like they did a year ago, but they were translating those yards on the field into points. And today they've had to settle for a pair of field goals from Rolfs.
That's right, and Navy's going to receive here to start the second half. And you know, Army's defense going to be back on the field. They have to continue to try to make plays, kind of bottle up Candido. Their offense has got to show some life sooner or later. And if not, Navy is going to take over this game quickly, and the momentum is going to be on their sideline again.
Navy to receive to start play in the second half. Austin Miller on the kickoff. Jeremy McGowan and Brian Hampton, the deep men. Second half action from the link. And a touchback as McGowan takes the knee. First half possessions for the Naval Academy. Got off to the big start with a 74-yard drive, and then the offense stalled a bit, able to recapture some of their rhythm at the end of that second quarter.
Yeah, that first drive, Ian, was a thing of beauty for Navy because it just showed you how difficult the spread offense was to defend. And four guys took the football, ran right down the field on them, scored a touchdown, and I think we all felt like, whoa! And Army probably felt that way on the sideline as well, but showed great resiliency, came back and stayed in the game.
Defensively for Army, Ryan Kent has returned number four. He left the game in the first half with an injury. But Kent is back on the field as Kyle Eckel picks up 7 yards for Navy.
You know, and Ryan Kent is a special player, a special person, a two-year captain, one of only six in the history of Army to be a captain for the Army football team.
He grew up 10 minutes from Philadelphia in Woodbury, New Jersey. His mom was able to set up a suite here at the link, 35 ticket requests. So Ryan Kent has a huge rooting interest here today. Craig Candido for 6 yards. Washington in on the stop for the Black Knights and a first down for the midshipmen. Candido has been limited to 21 yards. You talked about Army taking that trip to Hawaii and the exams they had to take on the plane. Well, Candido, one of the biggest weeks in his football career, he had two papers due, a Civil War reconstruction paper and an economics paper. I had no idea what he was talking about on either. Kyle Eckel, the carry. We did a lot of nodding in our meetings when we talked to them about their majors, mechanical engineering, engineering psychology.
Yeah.
And you and I looked at one another, just kind of nodded our heads.
The mechanical engineering was pretty good because they were talking about how that was the study of stresses and strains.
Yes.
And you and I both looked at each other. Is he talking about broadcasting?
Really depends who you are, of course.
Right, exactly.
On these strains and stresses. Navy continues to rotate its wide receivers with Jenkins, Wesley, Tomlinson, Yokitis. But it's been the running game, the bread and butter, as expected. Kyle Eckel trying to shed tacklers at Army, throws him back. Forward progress moves him to the 44-yard line. Washington the tackle. As we check in with Tim Brando in New York.
All right, Ian, it's been a turnover problem all year for Mike Riley and his Beavers, and they do it again. Derek Anderson is picked off by USC's Will Poole. He'll take it back 67 yards for the touchdown. Second pick for Poole today. And by the way, not since October 20th of 2001 has USC lost a game in which they led at the halftime.
So all the numbers bode well for the Trojans. First and 10 here, Candido. Good move to avoid a loss on the play. And he picks up a yard. Ryan Johnson, the junior from Berwick, Pennsylvania, able to sniff him out as he came out of the pocket.
You can see this play starts to the left and is going to come back to the right. That's part of the misdirection package that Paul Johnson has as this offense. But as you said, Ryan Johnson stays at home, makes a nice play on Candido. So again, you know, Army's defense is doing a pretty good job of slowing these guys down. And this is the situation now, second and long. You got to stop again. You can't give them third and short. That's where they become so dangerous.
Second and 9. Candido to throw. Open Tony Lane. First down and some bonus yardage along that sideline as they move it deeper into Army territory. A gain of 16 through the air. They don't throw it often, but Candido has been effective this season.
Especially in that area of the field for this particular game, nobody is covering the flat area for Army. One time they got out underneath that flat receiver. They sacked Candido. But I would think that if you're the offense coordinator, Navy, you got to keep going back to that because they've been wide open pretty much all game long in that situation.
First and 10 inside the 40. And Michael Brimage carrying, the junior from Birmingham, Alabama. His father, Clyde, is in the Army as a first lieutenant, so you can imagine what's happening at the dinner table when the family gets together, especially in regards to this game.
Well, you know, I have a little history of that myself.
You know, that's true.
You know, my father was an artillery man for World War II, and my uncle, Alan Huttenberg, was the youngest ensign in the Navy in 1941, and he was on the Nevada. So I understand a little bit the family ties to this game.
Interested observers,
yes,
in the Esiason family for this one here today. Tony Lane cutting it outside, and Army reads it. Ryan Kent, Johnny on the spot, a former quarterback who has developed into a tremendous linebacker.
You know, the other interesting thing about Ryan Kent, he's also a punt returner. I've never heard of a linebacker as a punt returner, but right here makes a nice play and a nice tackle. Now, again, you talk about plays in a game that are so significant. This is one of those plays right here for the Army defense. They've been bending. This is the point where they have to stop it now.
Probably two down territory, knowing what Navy likes to do. Third and two, it won't matter. Echo grinding out yardage. Nick Wilson on that left side with a key block. And Kyle Echo picks up six and another Navy first down. He has cracked 100 yards on the day.
And this offense is methodical in the way that it does things. And remember, at the beginning of the game, we talked about you have to stop the fullback, and it all starts there. Take a look at this as the fullback comes right at you. Look at those legs. Keep churning, and third and two. Over 100 yards already for Kyle Echol.
Echol, 33 ticket requests for family and friends. What a last-minute request. He had to work hard. Candido. What a grab by Roberts, stabbing it out of midair with one arm and bringing it to his body for a 19-yard pass play.
Oh, what a terrific play by Roberts as Candido tries to hit him right down the seam. Watch, Roberts goes right down the seam here, hand up, wide open for a touchdown. But what a nice adjustment by Roberts going back and catching it one hand with his left hand.
And it sets up a first and goal from the 5 for Roberts. What a double threat he is. Out of the backfield. Didn't play as a freshman, but showing his ability in his sophomore and junior year. Echol cannot take it to the end zone. Comes up shy. 3.5-yard gain. It'll be second and goal. Now for Navy, chance to win their 8th game of the season. This team won 2 games last year. One of those victories, the lopsided win over Army.
Well, Candido told you, he said, we're the senior class. We want to get Navy football back on the map again, and so far they've done that this year. And to cap that off would be a victory today against Army.
On second and goal, Roberts into the end zone, off the pitch. Touchdown, Midshipman. Chance to make it 20-6.
Do you take the fullback? Do you take the pitch back? Do you take the quarterback? This time it's a pitch just like they did on the first series of the game, Ian, and so many different weapons they have in this offense.
And this is what we talked about just before the start of the third quarter. You felt that Navy was a play or two away as Rolfs adds the extra point for maybe breaking it wide open. We'll see if the Army offense can respond after the 2-yard touchdown run from Eric Roberts. His second rushing touchdown of the day. Army-Navy, the tradition, the history, and Navy with a third quarter lead.
There, you know, you got to go both. He's got some beautiful jackets over here, and so do Army. I got to get one of these jackets. I mean, these overcoats for both of these groups.
You've been going gaga over the grays.
Oh,
the Army grays.
The core. Man, I'll tell you what, you take a look at them, you see them come out here, the march on before the game is so impressive. And it's just a great feeling when you're here, and the emotion in the stadium, and the chanting back and forth between the brigade and the corps, and it's a great spectacle, and it's fun to watch, it's fun to be around, and to visit with these folks, and to go to West Point, and to go down to Annapolis. You know, I played at Maryland, so I've been to Annapolis quite a few times. It's a beautiful city, and it's right there where the Chesapeake meets the Severn, and it's absolutely picturesque, and Anybody who's never been there, I tell you, you got to go. You got to go see Annapolis. It's a beautiful place.
And a terrific scene at the end of the game. The two teams stand at attention. They face the student body of the losing team, sing their alma mater with pride, especially after a victory. Blumenfeld on the kickoff. Navy doing exactly what it wanted to do to start play in the third. White mishandles it initially. Here's White, cannot find an opening. And he crosses the 20-yard line before David Mahoney, the freshman linebacker, makes the play. So the onus is now on the Army offense to get the Black Knights back into it.
By Earthlink.
This is the 15th different venue to host the Army-Navy Classic as we welcome you back to Philadelphia. 9:42 to go in the third. Army's first possession of this second half. And a first and 10 from the 21 for Zach Dahmann and the Army offense. Dahmann on the draw play. Jones has some room. Carlton Jones, a shifty running back, crosses the 30-yard line. And he gains 11 yards before Eli Sanders makes the stop defensively. Time now for our Aflac trivia question. And our question here today, what are the only three cities to host the Army-Navy game just once? We'll have that answer coming up.
Well, I will say that Philadelphia, this is where it belongs. It's my own personal feeling. And Philadelphia, people here, the city, just great hosts for this game. And the stadium, as we alluded to earlier, you know, was underneath blanket of snow, and they did a great job getting ready for this game.
On first down, fake the handoff, off play action. Dahmann has the time, floats it to the outside, caught by White. William White, the junior, hauls it in. We talked at great length to White. His grandmother has been such a huge influence in his life, Rosalie Dawson. He told us she doesn't understand football, so we can tell Rosalie, who's watching right now, that was a good play.
That was a really good play, not only by White, but his quarterback, Zach Dahmann, as White goes up for the ball. And Rosalie, when he's extended like that with his arms in the air, he's thinking he's going to get hit in the ribs. So he's got to have a great deal of courage to come down with that football.
William White gives Army a first down. From the 44, Dahmann checking off a three-receiver set. Lamar Mason scooting to the outside and knocked out of bounds. Bobby McLaren in on the hit. A one-yard gain on the outside by Mason. Offensively for Army in that first half, not a lot of success. That third drive stood out where they scored the touchdown, but they were unable to complete the extra point.
And look where that drive started. And, you know, the reason it started there is because Navy attempted a fake punt that didn't work. So they kind of helped Army out there a little bit, but Army took advantage of it. Now they're moving it again on offense. It's exactly what they got to do. A little screen, little draw play, some reverses, and see if they can get Navy's defense a little bit off the balance here.
Second and 9. Play action again. Dahmann rolling out. Wide open. He was unable to make the connection to Doug O'Ray, the tight end. It was Jeff Vanek, the defensive end, trying to chase him down. Zach Dahmann and O'Ray, the junior from Lafayette, Louisiana, would have had a first down.
And you can see what the offense coordinator, John Bond, is trying to do. Move his young quarterback out of the backfield. Little play action pass, bootleg to his right. Threw it behind the tight end. He had him wide open. Perfect play call, just not executed. And you know, again, you go back to the coaching situation of Army. Not an easy situation for these coaches. They all know that this is their last game in Army. And there is a search out there for a new head coach, and we'll talk about that in a moment.
Third and 9 for the Black Knights. Dahmann straight back. He's got the safety valve, but he'll go over the middle. O'Ray redeems himself for a first down. Into Navy territory across the 45 for a 12-yard hookup.
This play starts at the offensive line, and what great protection Dahmann has. Look at this job by the offensive line. He has the poise to come down through his progressions and hit one of his safety valves. And O'Ray makes a nice catch and then turns up and gets the first down. And they love Dahmann's poise in the pocket. He's showing that here now.
Dahmann will throw again. Fires to the 30-yard line, and Aaron Alexander spilled out after after another Army first down. The junior from Louisiana, over 60 catches this season. He holds the single season Army record.
Now, when you're a play caller, you can sense when your player is playing confidently, and right now Domin is doing just that. All of these balls are accurately thrown. Take a look at this, right in the breadbasket, perfectly thrown ball by Domin.
And another first down for Army, 13 yards on that pass play. We'll go to the run. Tyler Robinson busting through. And Robinson takes it to the 22. 8-yard gain for the freshman.
Talking to John Mumford, the interim head coach of Army, we were talking about the fact that there's no give up in this Army team, that they do mount furious second half comebacks. You know, they get down pretty deep, but they always come back into these games, and that's a testament to his coaching staff and, of course, to the character of the players on the sideline.
Yeah, Mumford told us it was bittersweet for him to take over for his friend, Coach Todd Berry. What kept him going? He said, the kids, they're fighters. You look in their eyes, and you just see special people. Robinson breaking tackles as he spins his way for another first down. Wojcik and Justin Troy up front with blocks. That's a 9-yard gain.
Everyone on the Army sideline, even the coach, told us that even one game can't erase the bad memories of 12 unfortunate games for them this year. But certainly when you meet the players and you see the way that they're playing, there is no give up. They are tenacious. They're going to fight. You know, that's why they're in the Army. Come on. Those are all the attributes that you want.
And Boomer, a point that's worth making. They've gone up against Conference USA competition throughout the year. Now they're seeing athletes on the other side of the field that are like them. Very balanced. Domin avoids it, throws, and knocked away. Bobby McLaren, the junior from Bethlehem, PA. It's like a home game for him.
You talk about these coaches and what they tell us and say, you know, Army and Navy, same type of kids. They're not the biggest, they're not the fastest, but you know what? They are smart, they are dedicated, they are intense. And as Bobby McLaren makes a nice play, probably one of the more intense Navy football players right there.
Yeah, we had a chance to talk to McLaren in the spring. He came in with a new attitude, and he really stood out to this coaching staff. He was running around out of control last year, not trusting the coaches. Domin throws and makes the connection with Alexander. No, Army inching closer with a 7-yard gain through the air. And they face a 3rd and 3. Army Black Knights passing yards in that first half, 12. They have nearly quadrupled that total already on this drive. And a key 3rd and 3 now for the Black Knights. Domin straight back. Floater. Picked off. It's McLaren. And the drive comes to a halt. O'Ray, the tight end, the intended receiver, as McLaren comes up with his first interception of the season.
Yeah, Zach Domin zeroed in on O'Ray. McLaren was standing right there, never even saw him. Here comes a blitz. Actually, it looks like it's a little bit of a fire zone where they take a defensive lineman, drop him back off in coverage. And Domin was a little bit confused by that and lost McLaren.
A tough force by Domin. We talked about the lack of turnovers in the first half. And this time they do turn it over. Army 43rd turnover, most in the nation.
And that one hurts because of where the interception took place.
Echol in the game. And Echol, he loves the contact through the gut. He picks up 8 yards as we head to New York and Tim Brando.
All right, Ian Boomer, I want you to watch the hands on this receiver, Mike Williams. Matt Leinart finds him like Velcro with the left hand. He is left-handed. That's incredible. 28-7 over the Beavers. But Derek Anderson comes right back, 22 yards to Tim Ewis, to make it a 28-14 Trojan lead at the break.
All right, Timmy B, thank you. Do you feel just a natural connection with the lefties, an unspoken connection?
I guess so, but I will tell you what, that Mike Williams, I could feel a connection to him if he were playing with me. That kid is something special.
Echol the carry, Ryan Johnson the stop, a 3-yard gain. And a 1st and 10 for Navy, 5:22 left to go in the third. Midshipman, 253 total yards. Keep in mind, they had 644 in that 63-34 win over Central Michigan.
You know, we said about 40 plays in the first half by the midshipmen. He could just feel like they just wanted to break out. Sooner or later, it was going to happen. They did it in the first drive of this second half. And now, again, moving and moving just like methodically.
5-minute mark of the third. Freeze option. Candido into a crowd. Knocked away. He was looking for Roberts. And the coverage was there for the Army Black Knights. Rob Davis helping to make the play. Monday, an all-new Late Show. Dave welcomes Academy Award winner Matt Damon, plus the latest Survivor Castaway. And later this week, don't miss Julia Roberts. Dave is all new, all this week here on CBS. Line of scrimmage, the 15-yard line for the Naval Academy. Under 5 minutes to go in the third. Navy 20, Army 6. And a second and 10 for the midshipmen. Candido. On the roll, rush coming, unloads, and picked off, intercepted by Stiff. Navy gives it right back as Greg Washington came in on a blitz, and he laid out Candido.
Well, it's all about pressure. Washington does that, but Stiff does a great job of hanging on the sideline, kind of baiting Candido into thinking that he's not paying attention to the inside receiver, and as soon as Candido throws the football, Stiff goes and gets it. So a little bit of the pressure, but also a nice play by Stiff in the secondary coming off the sideline. You see that? Now watch the hit that Candido takes right here. That's what happens when you don't block somebody.
Greg Candido doesn't turn it over all that often. But with the rush coming, Army gets it back. 4:47 to go in the third. Trailing by two touchdowns. Double fake. Airing it out down the sideline, Dahman, and it's incomplete. Vaughn Kelly was out of bounds, the junior from Coconut Creek, Florida. Aaron Alexander, the intended target. Let's wrap up the Aflac trivia question. We asked you, one of the only three cities to host the Army Navy game one time, and the answer: Princeton back in 1905, Chicago in 1926, and Pasadena 1983.
This is where it belongs, right here in Philadelphia, with the Liberty Bell and all that is associated in the history of this city, and how well they host these two academies and this beautiful new facility. How about this Lincoln Financial Field here?
Penalty. Second down.
Seth Neiman on the false start. Yeah, Boomer, I got to agree with you. Philadelphia, the perfect town. This now the perfect setting. They will have it here starting this year to 2006, then again in 2008. Baltimore gets it in 2007. Only the second penalty here this afternoon. And I think you're rather fond of the broadcast booth. It's roomy.
Yeah, I guess it is. All right. Yeah, I am.
Dahman guns it. And a turnover. Navy claims they've got it. Eli Sanders off the deflection. Walter Hill unable to bring it in cleanly.
Well, tough spot for Walter Hill, cutting across the middle, ball a little bit high, and you'd like to think he'd be able to come down with it, but unfortunately it leads to an interception.
Dahman, second of the day. Navy up 20-6 in the third. Navy 20, Army 6, 4:33 remaining in the third quarter here in Philadelphia. After a mistake-free first half, turnover, turnover, turnover here in the third quarter. And Navy regains possession with a first and 10 at the 19. Candido fakes the pitch and carries it himself as Craig Candido is inching closer to 1,000 yards on the ground this season. Brian Hill, the linebacker, makes the stop.
I can't even comprehend that number, and to be honest with you, I think for all the years that I played football, that's including Little League football, high school football, college football, and pro football, I don't think I had 1,000 yards.
We actually have the math done. It was 989. You came up just short. It was that first year of Pop Warner, I think, that cost you. Echol. And Army there defensively to limit him to a 2-yard gain. Under 4 minutes to go now in the third.
Now, we were talking about the coaching search for Army. Now, these coaches on the sideline are going to coach to the last minute of the last game, and they are all obviously extremely disappointed for Army because they know this is it for them. And you know what? Army has made a significant improvement in its facilities. Over $55 million of private donations spent on their facilities back at West Point. So whoever the new coach coming in is going to get a great facility. They're leaving Conference USA after next season, and they'll have a much more competitive, I believe, schedule. So you're going to have a real chance to be successful at West Point.
No gain for Candido on third down, so Navy will be forced to punt. And the story circulating, John Mumford, the interim head coach, but Frank Solich, recently let go by Nebraska, had discussions this week regarding the head coaching position at West Point, but he has withdrawn his name from consideration, citing timing as the reason why, after spending so many years at Nebraska. Skaggs, the punter, takes a bounce. Free football at the 44. Navy claims they've got it. It took a bounce, and Army is going to hold on to it. And good field position at the 43-yard line. Army still within striking distance. Late stages now, third quarter in Philly. 20-6, Navy with the lead here in the third quarter. Coming up Sunday on CBS, 60 Minutes. That Abercrombie & Fitch has withdrawn its Christmas catalog as too racy is not the only too racy thing being said about them. Sunday on 60 Minutes, followed by Cold Case, then Emmy winner Tyne Daly and Jamie Gertz star in Undercover Christmas Sunday here on CBS. First and 10 for Army at the 43-yard line. Zach Dahman got into a groove throwing the football. They go back to the ground. Carlton Jones bouncing off a tackler, and he picks up 4 yards. Eddie Carthen, the senior co-captain, makes the stop.
Hey, you said that Zach Dahman got into a little bit of a groove right here. Nicely thrown balls perfectly right there, just showing poise in the pocket. Then, unfortunately, he tries to hit Ore for a touchdown here, and McLaren steps right in front of it. So, got to get back on track here for Zach Dahman. Continue to throw on first down. That's what I'd like to see them do.
Only the second Army QB to throw for over 2,000 yards in a season, Lehman Hall, the other. Back in the late 70s, Tyler Robinson, the carry. And he brings it out near midfield. A 3-yard gain. Carthen again involved in the stop.
You know what I really thought was interesting? When we were talking to Joel Glover, he's the left tackle for Army, and he was telling us about how they call Zach Dahman Opie or Red because of his red hair. Last year he played as a freshman. You're a plebe at one of these academies. It's not the easiest thing to do. And then when you got to walk in there and be the leader of the upperclassmen on the football field, and I think Zach Dahman, you know, got the respect of his teammates because of his situations last year that he found himself in.
Yeah, he had a tough Beast Barracks at the beginning of his first year at West Point.
I laugh because we know what the Beast Barracks is all about.
First down throw to Aaron Alexander into Navy territory. And a new set of downs for Army to work with. Survivor Week kicks off Thursday with an all-new episode. The women have the numbers, but do they have a plan to beat the boys? Then Sunday, it's the surprising season finale. You can't miss it. Survivor Week begins Thursday, followed by the season finale next Sunday on CBS. Down to a minute 23 and counting in this third quarter. Army in desperate need of a touchdown to put some pressure on the midshipmen. Give to Robinson. Tyler Robinson leaving his feet and picks up 7 in the process. Seth Neiman, a good job pulling from that right side.
Take a look at this hole by the offensive lineman on the left side right there. His left guard, Adam Wojcik, leads in there. There's nobody there to hit. I don't know where anybody was in the defense.
Seth Neiman, a junior from Calvin, North Dakota, his high school valedictorian, and speaks at a much higher level than Boomer and I could possibly understand. A lot of these guys do, let's face it.
Easy there, I am, okay?
I'll speak for myself.
Okay.
Second and 3. Robinson banging his way for a gain of 1.
Do you care to explain what the Beast Barracks is all about?
I only know this much. They wear you down. You're a plebe, you're a freshman, and they teach you about the structure and order of going to a military academy, and they do it very quickly.
So if you're a freshman quarterback coming into the pocket, I mean, into the huddle, and you're going to have to talk to all of these upperclassmen.
That's a fair point.
Just think of that for a moment. Zach Diamond actually learned a little bit on the road last year.
End of the third quarter here in Philadelphia. 20-6, Navy leading Army. Will come back to the city of brotherly love after this message and a word from your local station. Army versus Navy, 2003 edition. Generals from the Army helping to lead the cheers, trying to get the Black Knights back into it as we start play in the fourth quarter. Ian Eagle, Boomer Esiason, Tracy Wolfson, and Dwayne Ballin with you here on CBS. 20-6, the midshipmen in front. Give to Robinson, and he is spilled out. He needed about two as Schwind combines with Mahoney to bring him down. It's very close. Now coming up next here on CBS, wrapping up a big day with college hoops and college football. The 2003 SEC Championship, number 5 Georgia against number 3 LSU. It's presented by Dr. Pepper. Tale of the tape between these two programs, both having outstanding seasons in the top 5. And both capable of putting up big numbers on the scoreboard.
Didn't our colleague Todd Blackledge say that if a losing team out of that particular game doesn't make it to a BCS bowl game, it would be a disgrace?
He did say that.
Well, he would know better than I do, but both of those teams, as you said, are having great seasons. As of, you know, they got to play these conference championship games. Somebody's got to lose, and you just got to wonder whether or not that loss is going to be so significant that they won't make it to a BCS bowl.
Right now, John Mumford is wondering what he should do on a fourth and less than a yard.
Go for it.
Got to.
Absolutely.
Trailing 20-6.
There's no thought process. They're maybe thinking about what play to run, and he's just counting on John Bond, the offensive coordinator, to do it because Mumford really has a defensive background.
He was the defensive line coach until he was named the interim head coach, replacing Todd Berry on October the 13th. Double tight end set, 3 in the backfield. They need a yard. Hand it off, Jones, second effort. Extending his body, and it appears to be enough.
Just enough, I think, as the Navy players think that they held Jones, but Jones stretched that ball out and looked like he had enough for second effort to get the first down.
And it all depends on the spot of the football. As Army is trying to keep this drive going.
The thing on the offensive line is you want to stay lower than the defensive line. The defensive line is trying to get leverage, stay underneath you. Ooh, look how close this is. First down.
Whoa! By the nose of the football, they've got it. And a very good spot as we just took a look at it on replay again.
Well, this is the situation now into the fourth quarter where Army, no, it's 4 down territory. You have to score. You can't really stop their offense as long as they don't turn it over, but you got to make something happen on your own offense. And this is why Mumford decided, look, we got to go for it. We got to get some momentum here. We got to see if we can get some points on the board quickly.
Well, Coach Mumford got a lot of emails this week from all over the world, from Baghdad to CEOs of major corporations. You know, there's a lot riding on the bragging rights for the winner here. Domin, a floater to Jones, creating after the catch. Bobby McLaren makes the stop after the 5-yard gain through the air.
And when you throw a screen pass like that as a quarterback, it's all about baiting the defensive lineman to you and not giving them the idea that the screen is coming, and that's exactly what Domin did that time.
Talk for a moment about Frank Solich. Did you think that was the right fit for Army?
He would have been a great fit for Army, I thought. I don't know what happened there.
On the handoff, Jones is pushed backwards by Jeremy Chase and company.
You know, Frank Solich had a great career at Nebraska. He's been out there for so long, and, you know, coming from West Point this week, and knowing Frank Solich and knowing the kind of guy he is and the character that he carries, he would have been the perfect fit for Army. I don't know what went on between the two, but I know if that was Army's first choice, that was a great choice because he is a great football coach and a great person.
Well, Army's upping the ante. They are willing to go to great lengths financially to get the right guy.
Right.
In that position as head coach.
They see what Paul Johnson has done for Navy. They're leaving Conference USA. They're going to have a chance.
On third and seven, through the hands of Aaron Alexander. And it sets up a fourth down. As we head to New York, check in with Tim Brando.
Ian and Boomer, the road to the Final Four, a little bumpy. Matt Loddick of Stanford, one of those big trees, hits a big three to help propel the Cardinal to a victory over number one Kansas. Fellas, we're 2 weeks into the season. Two number ones have fallen, and Michigan State, Tommy Izzo's team, already has three losses.
That's good to see. We picked up where we left off last year, the unpredictability of college basketball within the first 2 weeks. This is a pivotal fourth and seven for Army.
You have no choice but to go for it here. They're doing the right thing.
13:05 to play in the fourth. Domet steps up, rush is coming, gets rid of it, and incomplete. Lane Jackson had a chance at it, and a penalty marker on the play as Jeremy Chase provided the pressure in the pocket. Navy has not been penalized here this afternoon. Army only two penalties.
Holding on the offense. Penalty is refused. First down, Navy.
Turn it down, and Army turns it over on downs after the call from Alberto Riveron. So Greg Candido, the senior, takes the field with a chance to put Army away.
Now, it's time for the block of the day, presented by Earthlink.
Here is fullback Kyle Echol. As he goes into the line, he is going to block defensive end Mike Clark. Getting Candido to the outside as he pitches it to Roberts, leading to a big gain for Navy. And Kyle Echol not only runs, but he blocks as well, and that's why he's chosen for the block of the day.
For more on Earthlink's block of the day, log
heating up a bit.
Fun, I'll tell you that. A lot of opinions.
Under 13 minutes to go now in the fourth. On the pitch, Tony Lane breaking a tackle. Lane down the sideline, a foot race. And he is forced out of bounds. Michael Resnick chased him down as Navy is going for the knockout punch.
Well, we talked about it, Ian, in the pregame, and talking about getting outside the triple option. One, no, he's not there. We're not going to keep it. We're going to pitch it. And outside come the big plays, and Tony Lane breaks the tackle right there. We haven't seen much of it tonight, but sooner or later, you knew it was going to happen. Army defense has been on the field an awful long time in this game.
Lane averages over 12 yards per carry. 54 on that play. Through the middle, Echol. He's in. Touchdown, Navy. You can call it fire and ice, thunder and lightning, but when you can go outside and then inside on successive plays, that's impressive.
It really is, Ian, and this is what the triple option is all about. Fullback, no. Quarterback, no. Outside, yes. Then come back, hand it to the fullback. He takes it in the end zone, and I think Army is demoralized at this point.
Two plays, 70 yards. And Kyle Echol finds pay dirt. Echol, originally from South Philly, a happy homecoming for Army defense in the. That one took only two plays, 70 yards, 54 of which came from Lane, and then the rest of it, Kyle Echol for the score.
Remember, Navy has the number one rushing offense in football in the NCAA, and we see why. And talking about a team that averages about 323 yards a game on the ground, and their last time out, 530 yards on the ground, and that was against Central Michigan in a game that they won 63-34. So right now, that triple option has got it going on.
Jeff Blumenfeld to kick. Lamar Mason, the junior from Anaheim, California, awaits. And this will be Mason from the seven, trying to get to the perimeter. Mason, flag is down. And he is tackled out across the 25-yard line at the 27 by Shalimar Brazier, 19-yard return. We mentioned Mason from California. 29 different states are represented on this Army roster. Penalty against the Black Knights. 27 players come from the state of Texas to lead the team.
During the run back, holding by the receiving team. 10-yard penalty, first down.
Coming up Sunday on television's most watched new drama, Cold Case. An anonymous caller confesses to a 14-year-old murder. Who is he and why is he telling police now? Detective Lily Rush is about to uncover the truth. Don't miss an all-new Cold Case Sunday at 8, 7 Central, here on CBS. Craig Candido, a lot of people asked him what could he do for an encore. And I think he knew there was no way he was going to match his individual numbers, but a victory would be enough for the Navy faithful. It's 27-6. Domit. Wobbly pass looking for O'Ray. Incomplete.
And remember also, Ian, if this score stays the way it is and Navy goes on to win, they take home the Commander-in-Chief trophy, which is a big part of the goal setting that Paul Johnson started out with the beginning of this year. He told me it was a winning season, a bowl bid, and then they get that Commander-in-Chief trophy and own it themselves. They haven't had it since 1981. And so far, it's looking good right now for Navy to reach all of their goals that they set before the season.
Well, Eddie Carthen told us two goals when he got here, to leave with two rings, a graduation ring and a bowl ring. And he's going to get both of them. Carlton Jones. He is spun down by Jeremy Chase. No gain on the play. Well, you mentioned the Commander-in-Chief trophy. Earlier this season, Navy took on Air Force at FedEx Field in Landover, Maryland. Second half action, Craig Candido capped off an 82-yard drive, 10-yard touchdown pass to Tony Lane. Then midway through the fourth, Navy put the game away. Kyle Echo on fourth down, a 4-yard touchdown. Navy 28, Air Force 25. Third and 10 for Army. Domin out of the gun. Domin has some room in front of him. Soft toss. Complete to William White.
You know, talking to Paul Johnson also yesterday, I was saying that, you know, what are the pluses about coaching at an academy? So, you know, number one, as all coaches will tell you, it's the kids. They are spectacular. They are smart. They are attentive. There's no talk back. I don't have to worry about somebody calling me at 10 a.m. in the, or 10 o'clock at night or 3 a.m. in the morning that somebody's in some sort of trouble. These kids are just spectacular to coach. It's not easy to recruit simply because of the requirements to get into the academies. But once you get in there and you meet these kids, it's worth every penny.
Alex Bradford on the punt. Tomlinson has a chance to return it from the 45. Gets through that initial wave, and then he is thrown down at midfield by Matt Maimon. Navy takes over possession when we...
Bill Goat reporting. Is at work on top secret plans for the big game. What a catch. The USS Connecticut has brought the team here to practice. Wait a minute, get a shot of this. A polar bear has wandered by. He sure seems interested in that rudder, but something's fishy
it's
here.
It's Army.
Yeah, get
it's
him.
Spying on him. Time to the yardarm.
Go Navy, beat Army.
Gotta be impressed when they bring in the animation. They're going the extra mile.
Well, you know, you talk to Paul Johnson, he tells you that he's gotten a few calls from a few admirals, and actually one guy called him this week and said, look, I hear that Army has a guy that they've taken off the intramural squad that's running back punts. We got to be awake for that.
Everybody's got an opinion.
Sure.
Someone else called him with a fake punt that he should incorporate into his game plan. Craig Candido carries for 5 yards as we go downstairs to Tracy Wolfson.
Thanks, Ian. Mr. Secretary, I'm here with Gordon England, the Secretary of the Navy. And Mr. Secretary, you were just overseas during Thanksgiving visiting the troops. What does this game do for their morale?
Oh, this is terrific for their morale. First of all, let me say hello to all the Marines and sailors that I visit in Afghanistan and Djibouti and our ships at sea. It's the middle of the night there, and I know they're watching the game. But look, this is very, very important to them. This is a competitive game, and we want to win because after this game, these men and women are leaders for America. We want them to win in their next endeavor. So now this is very important. It's entertainment, but it's also important to all of our men and women, not just our sailors and Marines, but our soldiers and airmen. So it's terrific to be here, by the way.
Thanks a lot, Mr. Secretary.
Hey, hello to all those great men and women out there voluntarily protect and defend our nation. God bless them.
We appreciate it. Thanks
a
lot.
Thank you very much.
Back to you, I.
All right, thank you. Third and four for Navy. Inside handoff, it's Echol. If they need four, he'll give them five and a first down for Navy. But the words down from the sideline remind you of the duty, the honor, the commitment that all of these young men have taken on by signing up at the military academy. Army and Navy, 104th meeting. And the 77th time it's been held here in Philadelphia. 27-6, midshipman Candido on a spin. And Candido gains one. Mike Clark, the tackle for Army. Let's check in New York now and Tim Brando.
Ian, you know, Carson Palmer won the Heisman Trophy a year ago, but today his Pac-10 and school record for touchdowns in a single season broken by Matt Leinart. Here to Reggie Bush for the touchdown, 35-14, USC looking to gain some sugar at season's end.
All right, Tim, thanks very much. On a second and nine now for Navy, under 9 minutes to go here in the fourth. Echol in the backfield, Candido drops back to throw, but now takes it through the middle. Excellent running by Craig Candido as he just passed 1,000 yards rushing this season for Candido, and the secretary enjoys that one. We take a look at this on our Jeep cam.
You know, a smart play design right here by the midshipman, simply because they've been running Candido out from one side to the other. This time he runs out, looks like he's going to pass, and it's a little bit of a quarterback sprint draw where he goes against the grain. So a nice play design by Navy.
16 carries, 47 yards for Craig Candido. This time he's tripped up. Greg Washington sliding in to make the tackle. No gain on the play. Candido over 1,000 yards rushing this season. Candido entered action number four in single season total offense in Navy history. Chris McCoy number one back in 1997, and Jim Kubiak holds down the number two and number three spots. But Candido's going to have a chance to top those numbers. Action today, and then the Houston Bowl coming up late December. On second and 10, Candido through a lane.
Wow.
Craig Candido is willing to take on the defenders and lower the shoulder. That's a 10-yard pickup for the QB.
That's such a concept that I have such a hard time understanding watching a quarterback do this. And again, Paul Johnson told us this guy is heart and soul. He is competitive. He is driven, and he is not afraid to take a hit. He's one tough guy, and certainly you need a guy to run an option in an offense like this. But that last play, I think, is indicative of the toughness that he has.
Candido on a first and 10. Motion man is Roberts. This is Echol. Runs into a wall initially, keeps the legs moving, and dives for the score. Touchdown, Navy. It looked like he was dead in his tracks to start. Not with Kyle Echol.
Sooner or later, all these plays were going to start to add up, and it's going to mean fatigue for the Army defense, and I think that's what you see right here. You see missed tackles, you see guys falling down to the ground, and that's the first sign of fatigue for defense, and I think that's where Army is. They've given such a valiant effort all the way up to this point. Sooner or later, you knew Navy was going to break through, and I think that's where we are in this game right now.
Eric Rolfs on the point after. Kyle Echol, 152 yards rushing, two touchdowns. It's been Navy domination in the second half. They've got the big lead over Army. For the eighth consecutive year, CBS proud to be broadcasting Army-Navy as the midshipmen lead it 34-6 in the fourth quarter. Army in jeopardy of finishing the year at 0-13. Kyle Echol doing damage, major damage in this second half running the football.
It certainly is. 29 carries, 152 yards, and two touchdowns, Ian. And it's a game to remember for him. Remember last year was Craig Candido with his six touchdowns. And think Kyle Echo tonight really just putting forth a tremendous effort from the fullback position.
His seventh 100-yard game this season. Echo had 167 yards rushing and two touchdowns against Central Michigan, Navy's last game out. Mason, the return man for Army, and this ball sails into the end zone, a touchback. Blumenfeld with a big boot. And Navy, 7 minutes and 18 seconds away from moving to 8-4.
Look at those jackets. Don't you love those jackets?
It's a nice look. I've got to
agree with 4,000 of them together on the field. I'm just telling you, it's a great sight. A tremendous sight.
Now, are you saying that you're favoring that look?
No. I'm not going there. I can't do that. Okay. I like the other jackets, too. They're nice, too. Overcoats, I should say.
Just over 7 minutes to go.
Well, that is sharp. Now, look at that.
It looks good in a crowd, too. I think you make a fair point. Out of the shotgun, Dobbin. Throwing on first down. Brought in by Alexander. Aaron Alexander, 23 yards on that reception. And a first down for Army. Well, for Alexander, he's had some big games. 12 catches, 145 yards against Tulane. He's a junior, and Army has a bunch of juniors on this team.
And he also became the single season reception leader for Army.
Alexander topping the old mark by Joe Albano, set back in 1970. Incomplete as we go downstairs to Dwayne Ballard.
And back in 1999, Graham White was a record-setting punter for Navy. As a matter of fact, NFL scouts were very interested. But duty called, he became a captain in the military and the Army, served in Iraq. Back on June 26, he along with a couple of members of his unit were traveling in a road in Iraq, and a car bomb exploded next to them, killing the two members with him. But he survived, and we caught up with him earlier this week down at Fort Benning, Georgia, working out. He has fully recovered, but he wanted us to know that this game, after this year, it's really meant more to him because of the events of this past year, and he wants us to remember two men tonight, Sergeant Timothy Conaway and Corporal Andrew Chris. Those are the two men that were with him on that road in Baghdad back in June.
You know, Graham White, thank you, Dwayne, had a chance to possibly make a career out of football as a punter. That's the level that he was considered at coming out of the Army. And obviously his life has taken a different turn. We're just glad to hear that he's okay, as that throw over the head of Carlton Jones, 5-year military commitment. Mm-hmm.
And that's the reality of the situation for these seniors here tonight on both sides of the ball, and they are so close to it, Ian, and you feel it, and you talk to them. And every person that I spoke to that was a part of these academies all told me that servicing their nation is the most important goal that they had going into the academies.
Alex Bradford will punt for Army. Tomlinson, the return man, fair catch. Just shy of the 30-yard line as we go downstairs. Check in with Tracy Wolfson.
Thanks a lot, guys. Well, I'm here with 1960 Heisman Trophy winner Joe Bellino. Joe, I know when you were deciding what college to go to, it was between Army and Navy. Why did you pick Annapolis?
Well, Tracy, I grew up in a great little town of Winchester, Massachusetts, northwest of Boston, about 6 miles. Heavy Navy influence. I went to school with a number of Navy juniors. And there are three or four Navy admirals retired living in Winchester, and that had a big reason why I went to the Naval Academy.
It had nothing to do with the blue and gray uniforms?
Oh, yeah, I think the Navy uniforms are much better.
Thanks a lot, Joe. Enjoy the game. Back to you, Ian.
Well, Joe, we got a big surprise for you because we've decided to take a look at what could have been for him in Army gray. He looks basically the same to me.
Now the anchors look nice, don't they? I mean, I'll tell you what, what a cover for Sports Illustrated when he won the Heisman Trophy. What a beautiful picture that was.
And a new QB for Navy, Aaron Polanco, has replaced Craig Candido. And Polanco on the rollout. Polanco takes it himself out on the perimeter. Aaron Polanco has averaged 6 yards per carry this season in a backup role to Candido. And Polanco, the junior from Wimberley, Texas, will have a chance to take the reins of this offense over next year. Lamar Owens will be given a chance as well.
You know, usually when you talk to teams and coaches, you get a lot of that speak. Well, we're going to give forth a great effort. You know, we respect our team, you know, the opponents and all that kind of stuff. And this week, I really felt like it was honest when they were saying how they respected one another. And we talk about it that they are basically opponents here for 60 minutes, but they're comrades for life. And that was the common theme through all of it.
A couple of players pointed to the fact that it's like playing your brother. You want to beat your brother, but at the end of the day,
he's still your brother.
He's your brother.
That's right.
And that's a fair way to assess the reality of this game. They're obviously fighting for one cause, well beyond football. First and 15, Navy's first penalty of the day. Marvin Dingle, a sophomore fullback from Coronado, California, gets the call, a 7-yard gain. Right now, let's take a look at the play of the game presented by Wrangler 5-star Premium Denim. Eric Roberts to Tony Lane. Down the sideline, Lane had that long run. A big run that set up the Kyle Echol touchdown. 54 yards.
That was the triple option at its finest. Fake to the fullback, quarterback pitches it. Slot back runs down the sideline for a long game.
And Polanco takes it into Army territory across midfield. Stith and Tarver collaborate to bring him down. That's a 4-yard gain for Polanco. His twin brother actually was attending the Naval Academy as well, transferred to Texas Tech. And that's the situation here. You have 2 years to make that decision. Once you hit your junior year, you've made the full commitment.
You know, the only thing I can tell you is if I make it through my freshman and sophomore year at these academies, I'm staying.
Yeah.
I'll go through that.
Halfway
done. Not staying.
Right. Third and four. And Polanco is forced backwards. Greg Washington, first man there. And a loss of one for the midshipman. Clock is stopped with 3:36 to go in the fourth. Army uses a timeout. They've got two remaining. Greg Candido, his team is moving on to 8-4 on the season. Again, 12-yard over Army here in the fourth, 3:36 to go.
Well, we thought coming out of halftime that Navy had the momentum, and sooner or later it was going to basically take over this game, and we felt like Army was on the field way too long defensively, 40 plays in the first half. And at the end of the day, it's going to come down to, of course, Echol, and it's going to come down to Candido. And you know, these guys are used to winning, and they've turned the tide here at Annapolis, and they've given themselves a bright future ahead of them, and that's exactly what Candido wanted to do coming into this year.
Well, they did change their scheduling a bit, which has helped to their advantage, and something that Army will do following next season. One more year in Conference USA as Skaggs punts it, hits the ground for a 33-yard punt.
You know, this was a real tough time for Army if you were a coach, simply because you were in Conference USA. You knew that the players that were playing on in those particular schools, most of them, couldn't get into your school even if you wanted them. So it was a tough deal for them. And now this coaching staff will leave after this game, and they'll go out and find another coaching staff. And I think it will be the right time to become the coach for Army because of those $55 million in improvements for the facilities. The amount of money that they will pay now a coach, a salary, will be significant. And the schedule will be more realistic, I think.
Dahmann throws to Carlton Jones along that sideline. And they pick up 4 through the air. Coming up on 3 minutes to play. Now a 2nd and 6 for Army. Dahmann again working out of the gun. Throwing once again to Jones, and he is out of bounds. Picks up 7, a first down. Let's check out the CBS Sportsline stat of the game. Rushing yards today. hovering around that season average. They've topped at 350 yards. Get complete college football stats at CBSSportsLine.com or on America Online. Enter keyword CBS Sports Line. Roger Staubach, Craig Candido.
What an honor for Craig Candido to be standing there with the great former quarterback of Navy. And you know, the interesting thing now is we watch Zach Dom, and this is so important for him. Remember, he's only a sophomore. 2 years to go for him. He's going to want to be able to do what this guy here, Craig Candido, did, and that was get back-to-back wins against their arch rival. Candido, two wins now against Army in the last 2 years. You know, that's a big deal, as we found out just talking to all of these people. The winner of this game, we have so much pride going forth in the offseason. And this young man's going to have a new coach, and he's going to have a chance to do what Craig Candido did, and that's win back-to-back games over the next 2 years against Navy.
Now a third and three for the Black Knights. Dahman, timing pattern, and over the head of Carlton Jones. Incomplete. Fourth and three coming up. And coming up Sunday on CBS, when an FBI agent hides his star witness at his mom's house, there'll be no peace on earth. Emmy winner Tyne Daly and Jamie Gert star in Undercover Christmas Sunday at 9, 8 Central on CBS. And that was not the plan for Zach Dahman to be a starter as a freshman and a starter as a sophomore. Reggie Nevels, the junior from Marion, Indiana, tremendous athlete, but he has not been able to stay healthy for this Army football team. Currently a virus keeping him out of action, and that has forced Dahman into more of a primetime role than the Army coaches expected.
But you know, the next coach is going to get an experienced quarterback back there.
Prior to the snap, delay a game on the offense, 5-yard penalty, you play fourth down.
And while the growth might be somewhat painful going through those young years with a kid like this, the reward, the next 2 years, the junior and senior season, and I wouldn't be surprised if we're here 2 years from now and we're talking about how Army football has reinvented itself, and he's going to be a big reason for it. Much like Candido for Navy, he can be that for Army, and that's probably hard for those guys to see that right now and for him to feel it because they're losing. But you know what? He's going to have a chance to do it again, and then again 2 years from now.
Bradford on the punt to Tomlinson, 27-yard punt.
There's the poster boy right there, boy. Tell you what.
Well, he looks the part. And the star of the baseball team as well. Star outfielder among the leading hitters in Conference USA. And how about this? He gets to play baseball this year, senior season, without spring football getting in the way.
He can only get better. Yeah, that's exactly right.
Lamar Owens. Now at the quarterback position for the Naval Academy. This is Owens. Little shake and bake move and nowhere to go. Well played by Ryan Kent. Kent playing in his final collegiate game. He will be around the football team though next year as a grad assistant before he gets ready for field artillery. That's his specialty.
Lobbing howitzers. Hey, you know, what was the most memorable part of the week for you? I think
sitting down with both the cadets and also the midshipmen in their respective mess halls and eating among them, chatting with them, and just getting to understand their lives, their day-to-day lives, so different than what you and I are accustomed to. Branston Carroll up the middle.
Yeah, I sat at a table that was so well represented, you know, from all around our country, all the different states, and just talking to, you know, the men and women, and how important, you know, the values that they're being taught at these academies are to them, and how proud they are to uphold those. And you know, it's just an amazing thing. And I tell people all the time, any one of those people you would be proud to say is your son or daughter.
On a third and three, Owens will try to take it himself, but he gets tripped up. Tom Farrington, the senior from Pittsburgh, and look out.
Oh, not tonight. You can't do that.
Oh, that's going to be rough.
It's freezing.
Paul Johnson doesn't know that it's coming and doesn't expect it.
Oh, he's got to know. I mean, he's not even paying attention. You know, he'd be screaming at one of his players, saying, you know, you're not paying attention. You don't have the instincts. We need the instincts, son. Well, Paul Johnson doesn't have any instincts right now. If he doesn't know, this is going to get dumped on him.
Well, we know that the midshipmen and The Black Knights have to accept discipline and comply with rigid structure.
Oh, they got him. They got
This is not structure.
Oh, he hates that. You know, coaches hate that. They don't mind it if it's in the heat of the summer, but right now, that's the last. Look at his face. They don't want this to happen.
Navy has won the Commander-in-Chief Trophy, bringing it back to Annapolis for the first time since 1981. 34-6. The midshipmen victorious.
Normally, they wouldn't have a chance to get back at those players, but since these guys are going to a bowl game, guess what? We got practice, boys. I'm going to remember that.
Next up,
Gatorade dump.
The Houston Bowl at Reliance Stadium, December the 30th. Could be Nebraska, could be Texas Tech. Upcoming for Craig Candido and the Navy midshipmen. We also want to thank all the good folks at West Point and Annapolis, Bob Beretta, SID from Army, for helping us out this week, and Scott Strassmeyer from Navy doing an outstanding job getting us prepared for America's game. Downstairs to Tracy Wolfson.
Thanks, Ian. Coach, you take the Commander-in-Chief Trophy. You get it back for the first time since 1981. How important is this win for your team?
Well, it's important. I tell you, it's, I take my hat off to our young men that play. They played hard. We didn't play as well as we played all year, but we found a way to win, and it's great to get the Commander-in-Chief Trophy back in Annapolis, and for the Brigade alumni, and especially for our football team.
How about for the seniors that are headed off to service? How big of a win is this for them?
Well, I think anytime you beat your arch rival, it's a great win, and hopefully everybody can enjoy it.
Thanks a lot, Coach, and good luck in the Houston Bowl. Back to you, Ian.
All right, Tracy, Coach, thank you very much. Time for the alma maters here at Lincoln Financial Field. A remarkable turnaround season for Navy. 8-4 headed off to the Houston Bowl. For Boomer Esiason, Dwayne Ballin, and Tracy Wolfson, this is Ian Eagle. It's been our pleasure broadcasting from Philadelphia, where the final score, Navy 34, Army 6. Coming up next, Tim Brando Olympus College Football Today, back in our New York studio. Thanks so much for joining us. This has been a presentation of CBS Sports. So Ryan Kent has a huge rooting interest here today. Craig Candido for 6 yards. Washington in on the stop for the Black Knights and a first down for the midshipmen. Candido has been limited to 21 yards. He talked about Army taking that trip to Hawaii and the exams they had to take on the plane. Well, Candido, one of the biggest weeks in his football career, he had two papers due. A Civil War reconstruction paper and an economics paper. I had no idea what he was talking about on either. Kyle Echol, the carry. We did a lot of nodding in our meetings when we talked to them about their majors, mechanical engineering, engineering psychology.
Yeah.
And you and I looked at one another, just kind of nodded our heads.
The mechanical engineering was pretty good because they were talking about how that was the study of stresses and strains.
Yes.
And you and I both looked at each other, is he talking about broadcasting?
It really depends who you are, of course.
Right, exactly.
On these strains and stresses. Navy continues to rotate its wide receivers with Jenkins, Wesley, Tomlinson, Yokitis. But it's been the running game, the bread and butter. As expected, Kyle Echol trying to shed tacklers at Army, throws him back. Forward progress moves him to the 44-yard line. Washington the tackle. We check in with Tim Brando in New York.
All right, Ian, it's been a turnover problem all year for Mike Riley and his Beavers, and they do it again. Derek Anderson is picked off by USC's Will Poole. He'll take it back 67 yards for the touchdown. Second pick for Poole today. And by the way, not since October 20th of 2001 has USC lost a game in which they led at the halftime.
So the numbers bode well for the Trojans. First and 10 here, Candido. Good move to avoid a loss on the play. And he picks up a yard. Ryan Johnson, the junior from Berwick, Pennsylvania, able to sniff him out as he came out of the pocket.
You can see this play starts to the left and is going to come back to the right. That's part of the misdirection package that Paul Johnson has as this offense. But as you said, Ryan Johnson stays at home and makes a nice play on Candido. So again, you know, Army's defense is doing a pretty good job of slowing these guys down. And this is the situation now, second and long. You got to stop again. You can't give them third and short. That's where they become so dangerous.
Second and 9. Candido to throw. Wide open, Tony Lane. First down and some bonus yardage along that sideline as they move it deeper into Army territory. A gain of 16 through the air. They don't throw it often, but Candido has been effective this season.
Especially in that area of the field for this particular game, nobody is covering the flat area for Army. One time, they got out underneath that flat receiver. They sacked Candido, but I would think that if you're the offense coordinator Navy, you got to keep going back to that because they've been wide open pretty much all game long in that situation.
First and 10 inside the 40, and Michael Brimage carrying, the junior from Birmingham, Alabama. His father Clyde is in the Army as a first lieutenant, so you can imagine what's happening at the dinner table when the family gets together, especially in regards to this game.
Well, you know, I have a little history of that myself.
You know, that's true.
You know, my father was an artillery man for World War II, and my uncle, Alan Huttenberg, was the youngest ensign in the Navy in 1941, and he was on the Nevada. So I understand a little bit the family ties to this game.
Interested observers,
yes,
in the Esiason family for this one here today. Tony Lane cutting it outside, and Army reads it. Ryan Kent, Johnny on the spot, a former quarterback who has developed into a tremendous linebacker.
Now, the other interesting thing about Ryan Kent, he's also a punt returner. I've never heard of a linebacker as a punt returner, but right here makes a nice play and a nice tackle. Now, again, you talk about plays in a game that are so significant. This is one of those plays right here for the Army defense. They've been bending. This is the point where they have to stop it now.
Probably two down territory, knowing what Navy likes to do. Third and 2, it won't matter. Echol grinding out yardage. Nick Wilson on that left side with a key block. And Kyle Echol picks up 6 and another Navy first down. He has cracked 100 yards on the day.
And this offense is methodical in the way that it does things. And remember, at the beginning of the game, we talked about you have to stop the fullback, and it all starts there. Take a look at this as the fullback comes right at you. Look at those legs. Keep churning, and third and two. Over 100 yards already for Kyle Echol.
Echol, 33 ticket requests for family and friends. What a last-minute request. He had to work hard. Candido. Oh, what a grab by Roberts. Stabbing it out of midair with one arm and bringing it to his body for a 19-yard pass play.
Oh, what a terrific play by Roberts as Candido tries to hit him right down the seam. Watch Roberts goes right down the seam here, hand up, wide open for a touchdown, but what a nice adjustment by Roberts going back and catching it one hand with his left hand.
And it sets up a first and goal from the five for Roberts. What a double threat he is out of the backfield. Didn't play as a freshman, but showing his ability in his sophomore and junior year. Echol cannot take it to the end zone. Comes up shy. 3.5-yard gain. It'll be second and goal. Well, for Navy, chance to win their 8th game of the season. This team won 2 games last year. One of those victories, the lopsided win over Army.
Well, Candido told you, he said, we're the senior class. We want to get Navy football back on the map again, and so far they've done that this year. And to cap that off would be a victory today against Army.
On second and goal, Roberts into the end zone, off the pitch. Touchdown, Midshipman. And a chance to make it 20-6.
Do you take the fullback? Do you take the pitch back? Do you take the quarterback? This time it's a pitch just like they did on the first series of the game, Ian, and so many different weapons they have in this offense.
Now, this is what we talked about just before the start of the third quarter. You felt that Navy was a play or two away as Rolfs adds the extra point for maybe breaking it wide open. We'll see if the Army offense can respond after the 2-yard touchdown run from Eric Roberts. His second rushing touchdown of the day. Army-Navy, the tradition, the history, and Navy with a third quarter lead.
There are no gold medals for the 4x4 that masters Arctic snow. There are no championship games for fording muddy water. And there are no finish lines for the one that makes it over stacks of treacherous boulders. So why do we make sure every Jeep 4x4 is trail rated to such strict standards of capability? Perhaps the better question is, why doesn't everyone else? If it's not trail rated, it's not a Jeep 4x4.
I never win anything. So the other day when I signed up for Singular Rollover, you know, to be protected from overages, they said, congratulations, you get 500 bonus rollover minutes.
500 bonus rollover minutes! A great time to sign up for Singular Rollover. Immediately start with 500 bonus rollover minutes. The value of rollover only from Singular.
I call it my woohoo plan.
500 bonus rollover minutes. Another reason Singular fits you best.
Thus does fear manifest itself. The fear one is about to pay too much. Fortunately, Helzberg Diamond's value promise is a very effective antiperspirant.
Helzberg Diamonds. Confidence comes in a burgundy box.
Out of gas, short on cash, but I know where we're going.
McDonald's dollar menu, a lot for a little.
The Georgia Bulldogs battle to avenge a tough loss against LSU while the Tigers battle for a chance to compete for the national title. The SEC Championship, next on CBS.
Ready?
Go Navy! Go Navy!
NCIS, Tuesday nights at 8 o'clock on CBS.
Go Navy!
Mark Harmon and the gang getting involved in the Army-Navy spirit.
You better be careful there. You know, you got to go both ways.
Yeah?
I don't care what you say. These guys got some beautiful jackets over here, and so do Army. I got to get one of these jackets. I mean, these overcoats for both of these groups.
You've been going gaga over the grays.
Oh, the Army grays. The core. Man, I'll tell you what, you can take a look at them. You see them come out here. The march on before the game is so impressive. And it's just a great feeling when you're here, and the emotion in the stadium, and the chanting back and forth between the brigade and the core. And it's a great spectacle, and it's fun to watch. It's fun to be around and to visit with these folks, and to go to West Point and to go down to Annapolis. You know, I played at Maryland, so I've been to Annapolis quite a few times. It's a beautiful city, and it's right there where the Chesapeake meets the Severn, and it's absolutely picturesque. And anybody who's never been there, I'd say, you got to go. You got to go see Annapolis. It's a beautiful place.
And a terrific scene at the end of the game. The two teams stand at attention. They face the student body of the losing team, sing their alma mater with pride, especially after a victory. Blumenfeld on the kickoff. Navy doing exactly what it wanted to do to start play in the third. White mishandles it initially. Here's White. Cannot find an opening. And he crosses the 20-yard line before David Mahoney, the freshman linebacker, makes the play. So the onus is now on the Army offense to get the Black Knights back into it.
And I don't even have that insurance.
What insurance, Santa?
The one that pays you cash if you're hurt and can't work.
Huh? Aflac, ask about it at work.
Can you just send down the toys?
Mom, Dad, this is Paolo. He's an exchange student.
Would you like something to drink?
Sit.
Wow, look at that.
It's the Vega Theater.
Amazing.
It's a Grand Vega TV with a Vega engine.
Of course.
DVD Dream System with progressive scan and digital surround sound.
Fantastico.
Lemonade?
Introducing the affordable Vega Theater from Sony.
Can't taste my beer.
I can't taste my beer.
I can't taste my beer.
I can't taste my beer!
I can't taste my beer.
I can't taste my beer!
I can't taste my beer!
Next time, try the light beer that actually tastes like beer. Great tasting, less filling, Miller Lite. Good call.
The Home Depot, college football on CBS, is sponsored by Aflac, Sony, DiGiorno, and by Earthlink.
This is the 15th different venue to host the Army-Navy Classic as we welcome you back to Philadelphia. 9:42 to go in the third. Army's first possession of this second half. And a first and 10 from the 21 for Zach Dahman and the Army offense. Dahman on the draw play. Jones has some room. Carlton Jones, a shifty running back, crosses the 30-yard line. And he gains 11 yards before Eli Sanders makes the stop defensively. Time now for our Aflac trivia question. And our question here today, what are the only three cities to host the Army-Navy game just once? We'll have that answer coming up.
Well, I will say that Philadelphia, this is where it belongs. It's my own personal feeling. And Philadelphia, people here, the city, just great hosts for this game. And the stadium, as we alluded to earlier, you know, was underneath blanket of snow, and they did a great job getting ready for this game.
On first down, fake the handoff, off play action. Dahman has the time, floats it to the outside, caught by White. William White, the junior, hauls it in. We talked at great length to White. His grandmother has been such a huge influence in his life, Rosalie Dawson. He told us she doesn't understand football, so we can tell Rosalie, who's watching right now, that was a good play.
That was a really good play, not only by White, but his quarterback, Zach Dahman, as White goes up for the ball. And Rosalie, when he's extended like that with his arms in the air, he's thinking he's going to get hit in the ribs. So he's got to have a great deal of courage to come down with that football.
William White gives Army a first down. from the 44. Domann checking off a three-receiver set. Lamar Mason scooting to the outside and knocked out of bounds. Bobby McLaren in on the hit. A one-yard gain on the outside by Mason. Offensively for Army in that first half, not a lot of success. That third drive stood out where they scored the touchdown, but they were unable to complete the extra point.
And look where that drive started. And, you know, the reason it started there is because Navy attempted a fake punt that didn't work. So they kind of helped Army out there a little bit, but Army took advantage of it. Now they're moving it again on offense. It's exactly what they got to do. A little screen, little draw play, some reverses, and see if they can get Navy's defense a little bit off the balance here.
Second and nine. Play action again. Domann rolling out. Wide open. He was unable to make the connection to Doug O'Ray, the tight end. It was Jeff Vanek, the defensive end, trying to chase him down. Zach Domann and O'Ray, the junior from Lafayette, Louisiana, would have had a first down.
And you can see what the offense coordinator John Bond is trying to do. Move his young quarterback out of the backfield. Little play action pass, bootleg to his right. Threw it behind the tight end. He had him wide open. Perfect play call, just not executed. And, you know, again, you go back to the coaching situation of Army. Not an easy situation for these coaches. They all know that this is their last game in Army. And there is a search out there for a new head coach, and we'll talk about that in a moment.
Third and nine for the Black Knights. Domann straight back. He's got the safety valve, but he'll go over the middle. O'Ray redeems himself for a first down. Into Navy territory across the 45 for a 12-yard hookup.
This play starts at the offensive line, and what great protection Domann has. Look at this job by the offensive line. He has the poise to come down through his progressions and hit one of his safety valves. And O'Ray makes a nice catch and then turns up and gets the first down. And they love Domann's poise in the pocket, and he's showing that here now.
Domann will throw again. Fires to the 30-yard line, and Aaron Alexander spilled out after another Army first down. The junior from Louisiana, over 60 catches this season. He holds the single-season Army record.
Now, when you're a play caller, you can sense when your player is playing confidently, and right now, Domann is doing just that. All of these balls are accurately thrown. Take a look at this. Right in the breadbasket, perfectly thrown ball by Domann.
Another first down for Army, 13 yards on that pass play. He'll go to the run. Tyler Robinson busting through. And Robinson takes it to the 22. 8-yard gain for the freshman.
Talking to John Mumford, the interim head coach of Army, we were talking about the fact that there's no give up in this Army team, that they do mount furious second half comebacks. You know, they get down pretty deep, but they always come back into these games, and that's a testament to his coaching staff and, of course, to the character of the players on the sideline.
Yeah, Mumford told us it was bittersweet for him to take over for his friend, Coach Todd Berry. What kept him going? He said, the kids, they're fighters. You look in their eyes, and you just see special people. Robinson breaking tackles as he spins his way for another first down. Wojcik and Justin Troy up front with blocks. That's a 9-yard gain.
Everyone on the Army sideline, even the coach, told us that even one game can't erase the bad memories of 12 unfortunate games for them this year. But certainly when you meet the players and you see the way that they're playing, there is no give up. They are tenacious. They're going to fight. You know, that's why they're in the Army. Come on. Those are all the attributes that you want.
And Boomer, a point that's worth making. They've gone up against Conference USA competition throughout the year. Now they're seeing athletes on the other side of the field that are like them. Very balanced. Domann avoids it, throws, and knocked away. Bobby McLaren, the junior from Bethlehem, PA. It's like a home game for him.
You talk about these coaches and what they tell us and say, you know, Army and Navy, same type of kids. They're not the biggest, they're not the fastest, but you know what? They are smart, they are dedicated, they are intense. And as Bobby McLaren makes a nice play, probably one of the more intense Navy football players right there.
Yeah, we had a chance to talk to McLaren in the spring. He came in with a new attitude, and he really stood out to this coaching staff. He was running around out of control last year, not trusting the coaches. Gaumann throws and makes the connection with Alexander. No, Army inching closer with a 7-yard gain through the air. And they face a 3rd and 3. Army Black Knights passing yards in that first half, 12. They have nearly quadrupled that total already on this drive. And a key 3rd and 3 now for the Black Knights. Gaumann straight back. Floater. Picked off. It's McLaren. And the drive comes to a halt. O'Ray, the tight end, the intended receiver, as McLaren comes up with his first interception of the season.
Yeah, Zach Gaumann zeroed in on O'Ray. McLaren was standing right there, never even saw him. Here comes the blitz. Actually, it looks like it's a little bit of a fire zone where they take a defensive lineman, drop him back off in coverage. And Gaumann was a little bit confused by that and lost McLaren.
A tough force by Gaumann. We talked about the lack of turnovers in the first half. And this time they do turn it over. Army 43rd turnover, most in the nation.
And that one hurts because of where the interception took place.
Echol in the game. And Echol, he loves the contact through the gut. He picks up 8 yards as we head to New York and Tim Brando.
All right, Ian Boomer, I want you to watch the hands on this receiver, Mike Williams. Matt Leinart finds him like Velcro with the left hand. He is left-handed. That's incredible. 28-7 over the Beavers. But Derek Anderson comes right back, 22 yards to Tim Ulis to make it a 28-14 Trojan lead at the break.
All right, Timmy B, thank you. Do you feel just a natural connection with the lefties? An unspoken connection?
I guess so, but I will tell you what, that Mike Williams, I could feel a connection to him if he were playing with me. That kid is something special.
Echol, the carry, Ryan Johnson, the stop. A 3-yard gain. And a 1st and 10 for Navy. 5:22 left to go in the third. Midshipman, 253 total yards. Keep in mind, they had 644 in that 63-34 win over Central Michigan.
And we said about 40 plays in the first half by the midshipmen. He could just feel like they just wanted to break out. Sooner or later, it was going to happen. They did it in the first drive of this second half. And now again, moving and moving just like methodically.
5-minute mark of the third. Freeze option. Candido into a crowd. Knocked away. He was looking for Roberts. And the coverage was there for the Army Black Knights. Rob Davis helping to make the play. Monday, an all-new Late Show. Dave welcomes Academy Award winner Matt Damon, plus the latest Survivor castaway. And later this week, don't miss Julia Roberts. Dave is all new, all this week here on CBS. Line of scrimmage, the 15-yard line for the Naval Academy. Under 5 minutes to go in the third. Navy 20, Army 6. And a 2nd and 10 for the midshipman, Candido. On the roll, rush coming, unloads, and picked off, intercepted by Stiff. Navy gives it right back as Greg Washington came in on a blitz, and he laid out Candido.
Well, it's all about pressure. Washington does that, but Stiff does a great job of hanging on the sideline, kind of baiting Candido into thinking that he's not paying attention to the inside receiver, and as soon as Candido throws the football, Stiff goes and gets it. So a little bit of the pressure, but also a nice play by Stiff in the secondary coming off the sideline. You see that? Now watch the hit that Candido takes right here. That's what happens when you don't block somebody.
Greg Candido doesn't turn it over all that often. But with the rush coming, Army gets it back. 4:47 to go in the third. Trailing by 2 touchdowns. Double fake. Airing it out down the sideline, Gaumann, and it's incomplete. Vaughn Kelly was out of bounds, the junior from Coconut Creek, Florida. Aaron Alexander, the intended target. Let's wrap up the Aflac trivia question. We asked you, what are the only 3 cities to host the Army-Navy game one time? And the answer, Princeton back in 1905, Chicago in 1926, and Pasadena 1983.
This is where it belongs, right here in Philadelphia with the Liberty Bell and all that's associated in the history of this city and how well they host these two academies and this beautiful new facility. How about this Lincoln Financial Field here?
Ryan. Second down.
Seth Naaman on the false start. Yeah, Boomer, I got to agree with you. Philadelphia, the perfect town. This now the perfect setting. They will have it here starting this year to 2006. Then again in 2008, Baltimore gets it in 2007. Only the second penalty here this afternoon. And I think you're rather fond of the broadcast booth. It's roomy.
Yeah, I guess it is. All right. Yeah, I am.
Domin guns it. And a turnover. Navy claims they've got it. Eli Sanders off the deflection. Walter Hill unable to bring it in cleanly.
Well, tough spot for Walter Hill cutting across the middle, ball a little bit high. And you'd like to think he'd be able to come down with it, but unfortunately, it leads to an interception.
Domin, second of the day. Navy up 20-6 in the third.
Let's see what we got today. Where's the jersey? There's the jersey.
You've been outbid.
I've been outbid.
Yeah.
That's it. I'm switching to Earthlink.
Speed up your internet with new Earthlink Accelerator. Web pages load up to 5 times faster than regular dial-up, and you don't need new hardware. Call 1-800-EARTHLINK and get 6 months of dial-up service featuring Earthlink Accelerator at half price. Move to Earthlink. It revolves around you.
Wow, you ordered pizza. You sure know the way to a man's heart.
I think all relationships are based on honesty.
Me too.
Look, before this goes any further, there is something you should know.
You're married?
No, it's the pizza. It's not delivery. It's DiGiorno.
For fresh baked pizza at home, it's not delivery, it's DiGiorno.
I knew you were hiding something. I can read you like a book.
And now try DiGiorno Deep Dish. Deep in toppings, deep in cheese.
The sharpness of titanium. Now available in the new Remington Titanium Series. The only shaver with titanium-coated trimmer blades. It could just make all other shavers obsolete.
Counting sheep will never be out of work again. Welcome to heaven.
No! You'll feel the difference the moment you lie down. Serta, we make the world's best mattress.
I did it. Will a confession lead police to a cold case killer?
You've been conning me.
What?
I can see it on your face.
All new CBS Sunday.
Navy 20, Army 6, 4:33 remaining in the third quarter here in Philadelphia. After a mistake-free first half, turnover, turnover, turnover here in the third quarter.